Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and once more it is my pleasure, as the Minute Waltz fades away, to introduce to you the four exciting personalities who this week are going to play in Just a Minute. And we welcome back Peter Jones, Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud, and Paul Merton. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits the producer secretary, Anne Ling, who has a stopwatch in one hand and a whistle in the other. She tells us how many seconds are going and blows the whistle when 60 of them have passed. And I also have in front of me all the subjects, and I'm going to ask our contestants, as usual, if they can speak on the subject I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. Derek, the subject is selling by telephone. Would you try and talk on that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, the first time that anyone tried to sell anything to me by telephone was a number of years ago. They rang one morning, bring, and another one, and I answered and they said, "This is the Arthur Murray School of Dancing. You have won a prize of a free lesson. We will teach you how to tango, quickstep, foxtrot, waltz, pasodoble."
And Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
It's giving by telephone.
Giving by telephone.
Only got one free lesson, then you had to buy all the others. That was the point.
Well, we've been at it for a long time.
I think it was a lovely challenge, Clement, but I still think that Derek wasn't actually deviating from the subject because they were trying to put something over which could be interpreted as selling. So, Derek, you have the benefit of the doubt. You keep the subject, get a point for an incorrect challenge, and continue with 37 seconds left, starting now.
Sitting in the Siam Intercontinental Hotel in Ramatou Road in Bangkok, the phone rang one day, and a girl said...
Paul Merton has challenged.
Repetition of phone?
Yes, right, because the word on the card... You can repeat the words on the card, in case there's some people who have never heard the show before, but the word is telephone on the card, not phone, and you repeat it there, Derek.
It's all right, I accept it. I'm not going to go fast.
But I must explain to the listeners, they sometimes look at me with such daggers as if trying to bluff me out of it and say, "You're talking rubbish, Parsons." Sometimes I do talk rubbish, but that's all in part of the game.
The trouble is, you see, you're in the springtime of your senility.
But it does take someone like you to recognise it, doesn't it, Derek? Paul, you have a correct challenge, so you take a point for that and the subject. There are 30 seconds left on selling by telephone, starting now.
Of course, one of the things you can sell by telephone is yourself. You can put over a distinctive point of view and create a characteristic in the people's minds who happen to be on the other end of the telephone listening to you. British Telecom have recently issued a number of guidelines. If you want to sound very powerful, they suggest you stand up when you're making a telephone call. They suggest also...
And Derek Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of suggest.
You suggested too much.
Yes.
And Derek has got in very cleverly with 5 seconds to go on selling by telephone, starting now.
They too try to entice young people to sell insurance by telephone. Companies...
Whoever is speaking as the whistle is blown gains an extra point, and on this occasion it was Derek Nimmo and Clement Freud. Will you begin the next round? The subject is diet fads. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Nicholas, I wonder whether, on a point of information, I've just written down diet fads and find it's an anagram of dead fist. If I repeated a clenched hand which had lost his life, would that be okay? Because it's the same as diet fads. But if you want to say no, diet fads are pretty pointless, stupid things. Like all fads, they bear no relationship to sanity or to intelligence. I know of someone...
Derek Nimmo's challenged.
On a point of order, obviously on a point of order.
I was waiting for someone who was going to challenge for deviation. I'm still trying to work out this dead fish from it.
Fish.
Oh, I see now. Yes, it is dead fish. Well, it took me so long.
Am I going too fast for you, Nick? I mean, yes. We can...
No, I just love it giving you a good cue so you can get laughs. You have the benefit of the doubt this time, Clement, and you get a point for incorrect challenge, and you keep diet fads with 28 seconds to go, starting now.
It is very odd that at one point diet fads included not eating anything which was likely to poison you or kill you or lay you low, and no one could have a soft-boiled egg or a fish. Today it is the wrapping, which is meant to be very bad for you. If you eat cardboard or cling foil or tin foil, it's incredibly evil and your life is shortened amazingly. I think biscuits and white wine, drunk and eaten alternatively.
Clement Freud began with the subject and also finished with it, in spite of being interrupted. And he got an extra point for speaking as the whistle went, and he's now in second place behind Derek Nimmo, then Paul Merton, and then Peter Jones. And Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject is verse. Will you tell us something about verse in 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Verse, of course, is an anagram of serve. There was a young lady from Ealing who boarded a bus to Darjeeling. It said on the door, don't spit on the floor, so she climbed up and spat on the ceiling. That is a particular kind of verse, that is, a limerick. There are many other forms of verse, there are stanzas, there are many...
And Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of there are.
There are, yes. So verses with you now, Clement. And 36 seconds starting now.
It is uplifting to notice that at one time, like when I was young, a verse meant... If one line ended with love, the next was likely to finish with glove. But that is no longer so. You now get moon rhyming with blue stocking or fly.
Paul Merton has challenged.
Deviation. You can't make moon rhyme with blue stocking.
No. They may try, but it doesn't actually rhyme. So you're quite correct. That is a correct challenge, Paul. So you take the subject back. Get a point for that. 17 seconds on verse starting now.
I was taught poetry at school, an appreciation of poetry, I should say.
And Derek Nimmo challenge first.
Repetition of poetry.
Yes, and it's verse that's on the card.
Yes.
So, Derek, you have a point in the subject, and 13 seconds on verse starting now.
Dirty British coaster with a salt cake smokestack butting down the channel in the mad March day. With
a Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition.
Of what?
I've heard it before.
So give Clement Freud a bonus point, because we all enjoy the challenge. But as Derek wasn't deviating, he has 4 seconds to continue on verse, starting now.
Corinthians chapter 1, verse.
Peter Jones, Peter, lovely to hear from you.
Well, I was fascinated, but it didn't come from the Bible, that verse.
No,
I know
it didn't.
Corinthians fairly thoroughly. And now it's not anywhere in it.
Isn't it? So what is your challenge?
Deviation.
Well, Peter, as we haven't heard from you and we're 5 minutes into the show, I'm sure you must be absolutely correct challenge. And you have 1 second, very brilliant of you, to get in on verse starting now.
It rhymes.
Jones was then attempting to speak when the whistle went, gained an extra point. He's now equal with Paul Merton in third place. Peter, your turn to begin. Would you talk on putting up a shelf? I don't know whether you ever have. I don't know whether you are much of a handyman, but tell us something about it, if you can, in just a minute, starting now.
Well, the first thing to do is to measure the place where you want to put it. If it's an alcove, be sure to get the right distance between each side. Otherwise, the shelf will either be too long or not quite short enough.
Oh, we get some wonderful attempts at English. The trouble is that so many people around the world listen to it, and I've been told they model their knowledge of the language on our show, which is very disturbing. Derek Nimmo, you challenge first.
That was not quite short enough.
And you... No, it wasn't hesitation. It was a lot of deviation. No. I think that...
Be browbeaten by him all the time.
Well, it's better than being browbeaten by you, I would have thought. Peter, you continue with 46 seconds on putting up a shelf, starting now.
No. Yes, well...
Derek Nimmo, you chant.
Repetition of well.
Yes. And, right, 45 seconds for you, Derek, on putting up a shelf, starting
when you get out your Black and Decker drill and some raw plugs, you bash into the wall, you bung those things into it, and then you get some planks and put them on top of those angle irons which so effectively hold it solidly and rigidly against the stone masonry, and then on to the top of it, when you put up your shelf, you put jars of marmalade, tins of fish, every manner of... What's the matter?
And Peter Jones is trying.
Well, he's giving us an inventory of what he's going to put on the shelf once he's put it up.
Absolutely.
Which is nothing to do with it. Deviation.
Deviation. That's not putting up a shelf. It's what you stack on it. Well challenged, Peter. 20 seconds for you, which you, the subject you don't want. Putting up a shelf, starting now.
Well, I was interested...
Derek has challenged you again, and I think I know...
Well, he
yes,
always
I know.
He started with well for 24 years. No.
I know,
and
he
I'm
does...
still here.
No.
So obviously something's working.
I'm sorry, but you have said that. So, Derek, you're back with putting up a shelf. 19 seconds, starting now.
You can buy kind of metal ladders which you put hooks into, and then...
Clement Freud challenge.
Can't put hooks in metal ladders.
Yes, you can. There are special ladders, little holes again. You put these little hooks in them that hold the planks on. You may not have done it yourself. You're no good at handiwork, Freud.
I don't describe them as ladders. No, I think, Clement, you have a correct challenge and 14 seconds on putting up a shelf.
They're described in a do-it-yourself shop in Australia.
They're called ladders,
aren't
they? I do have the authority to ask the audience to leave, you know. All right, I will always be fair. I always try to be fair. I will always bow to the superior judgment of the audience. You think these things are called metal ladders, are they?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, it was before my time, obviously.
After your time.
All right, I will put... If you agree with what Derek said, you cheer for him, and if you disagree, you boo, and that is for Clement. So all do it together now.
Boo.
Derek, you have the benefit of the audience's doubt. And you keep the subject. Another point. 14 seconds. Putting up a shelf. Starting now.
I've looked through Chippendale's directory for instructions on how to put up a shelf. He has wonderful designs for them, but no actual rules for fixing them to any kind of wall or...
So Derek Nimmo was speaking then as the whistle went and has increased his lead at the end of that round, having gained one or two points, including one for speaking after 60 seconds. And Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is adders. Just a minute, starting now.
One of my favourite kinds of an adder is an abacus. And I was in the Friendship store in Ho Chi Minh Avenue, which leads into Tiananmen Square, last week. And there, every assistant was using this particular variety of adder, which consists of little metal balls on wires, and very rapidly they move them up and down. Now, a snake, which is an adder, is a very venomous creature, a viper, in fact, unless, of course, perhaps if it's a puff adder, and perhaps they have different inclinations, I don't know.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Two perhapses.
Clement, you have the subject for 27 seconds on adders, starting now.
Difficult not to notice that adders is the same as sadder if you reverse the S and put it at the beginning. Anagrams appear to be very popular in setting subjects in just a minute. I don't like adders.
Derek Nimmo's challenge.
Whatever subject we've got, does he start talking about the Times crossword? Why do we have to go doing anagrams all the time?
So what is your challenge?
Deviation.
Yes, because he's talking about anagrams and not about adders. Yes, I agree with Derek. So 13 seconds are left on adders with you, starting now.
A pocket calculator is a very good form of adder. And without one, I don't think I would be able to negotiate the world.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, he did stumble there, Peter. So you have a hesitation and 5 seconds to tell us something about adders, starting now.
I've been told that they're not dangerous unless you annoy them. I did hear of someone
Paul
who had...
Merton challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
Pocket calculators aren't dangerous at all.
give Paul a bonus point because we enjoyed the challenge. And Peter gets one for being interrupted because he didn't establish what he was talking about, but we assumed it was vipers, and the subject is still with you. Adders, and a half a second to go, Peter, starting now.
Unless you annoy them.
So Peter Jones was then speaking again as the whistle went, gained another point. And at the end of that round, Peter has leapt dramatically forward. Derek Nimmo still in the lead, but then it is Peter Jones, and then Clement Freud, and then Paul Merton in that order. And Clement, it's your turn to begin. The subject is swashbuckling.
Swash is the sound made by the lapping of water, and buckling is a smoked herring, usually from Lowestoft or thereabouts. And for some extraordinary reason, a swashbuckler is someone who is a bully and a grandiose, swaggering, unpleasant, nasty, usually sword-bearing man who does unkind things to people smaller or more timid than he. Among famous swashbuckling practitioners in history are those who have taken from the rich and given to the poor, usually their wives and children, and those on trains between York and London who played games when they might have eaten sandwiches, which is a rotten thing to do on British Rail.
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
He's just trying to advertise the fact that he makes the sandwiches for British Rail. And while we're on this point, he has for years...
I should have thought he'd want to keep quiet about that.
Mm. No, they're very good sandwiches, but it's just a matter of interest to show you what a sort of hypocrite he is. For years and years, he's refused to give anyone an autograph, but every single one of his sandwiches on British Rail is signed.
I get up very early every morning and do those.
Derek, I disagree with your challenge, but you get a point because we enjoyed it.
What was my challenge?
I don't know, but everybody enjoyed it. And I'm being very generous and giving you a bonus point, but Clement gets one for being interrupted. Keeps the subject, swashbuckling, starting now.
Many people think that a swash...
Derek Nimmo.
Repetition of people.
Yes, you did talk about people before. Yes, don't look like that, Clement, because I was listening. Derek has the subject. 7 seconds on swashbuckling, starting now.
Well, swash was the name given by a sword as it actually tapped upon the buckle, which was the shield. In the same way that...
So, Derek Nimmo again spoke as the whistle went, got an extra point, and others in the round has increased his lead. And Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject is quacks. Can you tell us something on that subject in 60 seconds, starting now?
People who are not properly qualified to practice medicine are often described as quacks, quack doctors, in fact. Now, there are several stories within the National Health Service of people pretending to be medical practitioners who have donned white coats and have duped various patients and other members of staff into thinking that they hold the appropriate examination qualifications. But they have often been found out after several years, and some have even been discovered to be better than the actual doctors that they are replacing. There was a man in Lowestoft, in fact, who had his right leg removed by an individual who turned out to be a plumber who had just come in to fix the radiators. This kind of malpractice is very common, more than you might think. Let me go into some detail over this one. The way I see it is, it's a noise that a duck makes as well, incidentally, which attracts other members of this particular species to the notion that there is a bird of the same kind in the immediate vicinity. Now, this is the longest minute, but...
It was a long minute, actually. It was 95 seconds. but the audience were enjoying it so much, Paul. We were very wicked and rather evil and let you go on and struggling away there. And though you were challenged for repeating yourself once or twice or pausing, we ignored it because we enjoyed it so much. You started with a subject, you finished with a subject, 1 minute and 35 seconds later, and you get not only a point for speaking when the whistle went, but a bonus point for not being interrupted, or for me not lying at the interruptions. And you're still in fourth place. But you're very close to Clement Freud, only one behind him. And, Peter, it's your turn to begin. Chambers. Can you tell us something about Chambers? Personal, or the reading kind, or whichever you like, starting now.
Chambers is a wonderful encyclopedia. I can't really speak too highly of it. I'd like to go on talking about it long enough to be sent a complimentary copy. I will begin by saying it contains geographical information, and biographical, of course. Several well-known people's names occur in it. Nicholas Parsons, I don't think, is in it, but that wouldn't really put me off having it. And I'd be very pleased to let the other members of the panel come to my house and look anything up if they wanted to. So I do feel that, I shall be expecting it Tuesday morning, first post. If there's any justice at all. There aren't any other books of this nature that are entirely British, and...
Daring Nimmo Challenge.
Well, quite a lot of albums, really, but I chose the last one to challenge on.
Because that was the longest one, right. Mm. Derek, there are 11 seconds left on Chambers with you, starting now.
The chamber is the part of the gun into which you put the cartridge or bullet before you fire it. You turn it round and then shoot. Cambridge of Commerce is not quite the word I meant to say, which is Chamber of Commerce.
Paul Merton challenged you before you went on. Paul?
Deviation.
Yes, indeed. Deviation from English and other things as well. And you've got in very cleverly with half a second to go on Chambers, Paul, starting now.
Chambers?
So at the end of that round, Paul Merton has moved forward into second place alongside Peter Jones. Derek Nimmo's out in the lead. Clement Freud's one behind the two in second place, and Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is Muddle. Can you tell us something about Muddle?
Well, Muddle's quite often what I get myself into when I play this game, because I tend to stutter, I have a speech impediment, and people leap and bop, what's
and Paul Merton challenge.
His speech impediment came rushing to the fore.
That's right, yes.
Hesitation.
55 seconds left on Muddle, Paul, starting now.
Muddle is a very tiny village in Shropshire. It has a population...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
No, it isn't. I come from Shropshire and it doesn't.
It's very tiny. You could easily overlook it.
Middle. There's a middle.
There's not a Muddle.
No. You've just made enemies of the people of Muddle, I can tell you that.
Well, if it's so small, it doesn't really matter.
So there we are. We'll risk it and say, Peter, a correct challenge. 50 seconds on Muddle starting now.
Well, it's a state of mind that I've really been in ever since I can remember. And I find it fairly comfortable. I don't like making decisions and deciding on certain ways in which I shall deal with things. I prefer to postpone them and say, well, I don't really know. In fact, I am one of that party. My 17%, say, of the people who are questioned give this reply. And I think that...
Nimmo challenge.
Well, I chose that particular hour again.
You let a few go, and then you came in. 24 seconds left on Muddle, Derek, starting now.
I think perhaps because I'm getting older and more enfeebled, I do become more muddled as the days pass by, partly due to my wife, who goes out of her way to drive me balmy. The extraordinary thing about women is they never get ulcers, but they're carriers. And I, because of this great muddle to which she is referring.
Derek seemed to strike a chord there, and he got a response from the women as well as the men in the audience. And he increased his lead, because he was also speaking as the whistle went. And, Clement, it's your turn to begin. The subject, the Taj Mahal. Will you tell us something about that magnificent edifice, starting now?
That magnificent edifice, starting now, is a white marble mausoleum at Agra in India, for which reason it's odd when you consider how many restaurants bear that same name. I went to the Taj Mahal in Tooting, and I would quite particularly like to recommend number 6, number 11, 24, 37, 48, and advise you to avoid anything over 80, which tends to be sweet and sticky. The Taj Mahal is genuinely one of the most sensationally beautiful buildings in the entire world. And when people denigrate Disney World or other places like that because everyone goes there, I would like to plead for an exception to be made for the Taj Mahal, which is just so staggeringly lovely that if Air India is listening to me...
On this occasion, Clement Freud took the subject and finished with it without hesitation, repetition or deviation, and was not interrupted, of course, so he not only... It's a point for speaking as the whistle went, but a bonus point for no interruptions. And at the end of that round, Peter Jones, Paul Merton and Clement Freud are all equal in second place behind our leader, who is still Derek Nimmo. And Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject, keys. Can you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I have a key ring in my pocket that contains several keys. There is the key to the garden shed. They're the key to my front door. There are many forms of keys as well in other aspects of life. For example, to open a tin of sardines, you sometimes need a particular key.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Well, it's the plural on the card.
That's right.
Exactly what I was challenged for.
Is the
before
singular.
The singular.
You well saying. Done, Derek.
He
yes.
says a little, well, little naughty challenge, which was done to me earlier on. So I'm just getting my own back.
Which you don't need to, as you always have twice as many points, but it doesn't really matter. But he did repeat the word key, and keys is on the card. So, Derek, you have 43 seconds to talk on the subject, starting now.
I...
And
hesitation.
Paul Merton challenged.
Hesitation.
Well done, Paul. You have 42 seconds on keys, starting now.
Just out...
Derek Nimmo.
Hesitation.
Nothing. Paul, you have another point for an incorrect challenge. And you have the subject of keys and 41 seconds starting now.
Just outside Muddle is an even tinier town called Keys. Now, the residents of this particular town...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Two towns.
Two,
yes.
Two towns there, yes. Clement, you have keys and yes. 35 seconds starting now.
Cecil Parkinson is the sort of name that springs to mind, which should never...
And then Clement said two words and then paused. And
I challenged myself for bad taste.
And what is your challenge, Clement?
Bad taste.
Yes. Well, you get a point for that. It was bad taste. So 23 seconds to talk on keys, starting now.
There is an island off the west coast of Scotland called Skye, which is an anagram of keys. I know people really wanted to know that. I have a bunch of keys in my pocket, just like my friend Paul Merton sitting on my right, in which I have the keys to several garages, many houses, a number of flats.
And Derek Nimmo challenged.
Bad taste, showing off.
All right, we say touche, Derek, and give you a bonus point for the challenge which we enjoyed. But Clement also, as he wasn't, strictly speaking, deviating, he keeps the subject. Another point to Clement Freud, and we're in the last round now, and the subject is still keys, and there are 3 seconds, Clement, starting now.
But the keys I like best are the ones to my front door.
As I indicated just then, that was the last round of this edition of Just a Minute. Peter Jones was 2 points behind Paul Merton, who was 2 points behind Clement Freud, but he was 6 points behind this week's winner, the one we adjudged to be out in front, the winner, Derek Nimmo. It only remains for me to thank our 4 panellists, also Anne Ling, who's kept the score so well and blown her whistle so admirably, also the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and our producer, Edward Taylor, and me, Nicholas Parsons. From all of us here, goodbye. Thank you. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and once more, it is my pleasure to introduce the four diverse and talented individuals who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back Peter Jones, Wendy Richard, Tim Rice, and we also welcome for the first time Richard Stilgoe. I have beside me the producer secretary, the lovely Anne Ling, who has a stopwatch and a whistle to keep the time and blow her whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I'm going to ask our competitors if they will speak without interruption, if they can, on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. Let us begin the show this week with Tim Rice. And who better? Tim, the subject is chop suey. Can you tell us something about that gooey subject in this game, starting now?
Chop suey is a kind of nosh. Not the food, however, coming from China. It is, in fact, a Californian invention, a bastard version of food from that place I mentioned before in the Orient. Never, ever have...
Wendy Richard has challenged. Wendy.
I think there was a slight hesitation.
Your thoughts are correct. I agree with you. So you take over the subject, gaining a point for a correct challenge. And it is chop suey, and there are 45 seconds left, starting now.
I disagree with Mr. Rice's interpretation of chop suey. I always understood it was invented by an Oriental gentleman who only had one saucepan to do his cooking in. So he put everything into the one receptacle.
A Tim Rice challenge.
Two ones.
Oh, he's not going to be picky, is he?
Well, the audience reaction shows you what a tough challenge it was, but I have to be fair within the rules of Just a Minute and say, Wendy, he is a tough challenger, but it's a correct one. So, Tim, you get the subject back, a point, and 32 seconds on chop suey, starting now.
This character from Eastern parts who flung all his food into one wok.
Richard Stilgoe challenged.
He said he was from California, which is Western parts.
Well, it depends. From China, California is east.
Deviation.
No, you're quite right,
degrees,
Richard.
Deviation.
Well, it depends where you are.
I agree with Richard. Give it to Richard.
After that last challenge, I knew you would agree with Richard, Wendy. But no, Richard, well, listen, because I think, to my mind, Tim established that he came from California. So, Richard, you have a point, and you speak for the first time on Just a Minute, with 27 seconds left on chop suey, starting now.
I'm sorry about that challenge straight away, because if you're called Rice, it must be incredibly embarrassing having to talk about chop suey. The aforementioned subject... Oh, no, I'm allowed to mention its name, of course, because it's chop suey, and that's the name of the thing on the card. It's...
Tim Rice challenge.
Lots of names there.
Yes, the name on the card and the name is... Yes.
Sorry.
It's difficult, isn't it,
you
Richard?
Charity.
Anyway,
no.
You have a point, and Tim has another point. And he has the subject back, and 12 seconds left, starting now.
The Chop Suey Club, just off the A6 near Preston, who once had a magnificent football team starring my childhood hero Tom Finney, who played on the right.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Now he's talking about football. And Tom Finney. That has nothing to do with Chop Suey.
But he was also talking about his hero.
Well, that's a kind of sandwich that is popular in America, a hero sandwich.
I don't think he got
somebody
sufficiently...
Somebody in Italy invented it. It was taken over to California and became very popular.
Peter, we did enjoy the interruption, but I don't think he got sufficiently involved in Tom Finney to call it a deviation.
Well, he's only got about 5 seconds left. I couldn't let him go on.
I thought there was a bit of a ploy behind it, Peter. I can't allow the challenge. And Tim gets another point for incorrect challenge, keeps the subject 4 seconds, chop suey, starting now.
An Italian gentleman started this.
Peter challenge.
A repetition of gentleman.
Yes, he did have a gentleman before. Right at the beginning, you had this gentleman from California, Tim. So, Peter, you got him very cleverly with 2 seconds to go, chop suey, starting now.
So he bunged everything into this one.
For those of you who don't know after 23 years that whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, I will remind you of that fact now, and also to state on this occasion it was Peter Jones. And Peter Jones, will you take the next subject, which is self-seal envelopes? 60 seconds as always, and you start now.
Well, I'd like to begin this short talk on self-sealing envelopes by saying that they don't very rarely work, you know. They kind of unpeel after you've tried to stick the two bits together. And this is a tremendous disadvantage if you've got something that you want to put in the post. Watching it unfurl as you walk to the post office.
Tim Rice, challenge.
I think it was grinding to a halt.
I think it almost reached the halt, and it was a definite there. And I think he was quite relieved that you challenged, gained a point, and you have 37 seconds to tell us something about self-seal envelopes, starting now.
This is a fascinating topic, mainly because there has never yet been invented a truly self-sealing envelope. Think about it. Envelopes never seal themselves. You have to do something, even if the two parts are previously sticky. If there was a man who could invent a truly self-sealing envelope, he would make a fortune. Imagine the joy, putting your letter into the envelope and sitting back and watching it close itself.
Wendy, Richard has challenged.
I think there's been envelopes other than coupled with self-sealing, which is what we're talking about. And are you not allowed?
The subject on the card is self-seal envelopes.
Yes, but then, just a minute, he picked me up on ones. Now, if you're saying envelope on its own,
right.
More than one.
Exactly. Is that your challenge?
That's my challenge.
Your challenge is correct, then.
Right.
Don't get so aggressive,
no,
Wendy.
No, all right. That's all.
16 seconds are left for you, Wendy, on self-seal envelopes, starting now.
I entirely agree with Peter Jones and Tim Rice about self-sealing envelopes. They don't work. There is nothing more annoying than putting one's letter into one of these self-sealing envelopes and pressing madly on the back of the self-sealing envelopes to find that...
So Wendy Richard, speaking as a whistle, when gained that all-important extra point... She's now in second place behind Tim Rice, who's still in the lead. Richard Stilgoe, your turn to begin. Will you tell us something about embarrassments in just a minute, starting now?
Embarrassments are the sort of thing that George Cole used to go through a great deal in a radio series called A Life of Bliss. This used to have as its signature tune, ba-da-da-da-dum-ba-dee, and then the programme itself would begin. He had a dog in it. That was me taking a breath, incidentally, not a hesitation. He had a dog in it whose name, as far as... Oh, damn.
The audience reaction is to Richard Stilgoe's hitting his head with his hand because he realised if you pause, you come back with the same sentence. And Wendy was the first to challenge. So, Wendy, you have another point, and you have 39 seconds to tell us something about embarrassments starting now.
We have all suffered embarrassments at one time or another, and I'm desperately racking my brain to remember one that has happened to me. I'm sure there must have been several, and I'm desperately looking at my husband. He's got to give me a sign to remind me about something. I think one of the embarrassing moments we have had was when I was driving. No, I wasn't in the behind the wheel. He was.
Tim Rice.
This is just dying on its feet.
You're quite right.
I mean, it's very embarrassing, frankly. I mean, I tried to keep my hand off the buzzer, but I couldn't.
Unsportingly, but the audience enjoyed it. Let her embarrassment go on longer than necessary because she had deviated in all kinds of other things. And we're left 15 seconds for you to continue, or no, take over the subject of embarrassments, starting now.
There was a very embarrassing incident, I recall, which took place in Spain, quite near Madrid, I believe, involving the local fire service. The two chief men of this company, called Jose and Hose B, were called out to a
Richard
fire.
Richard Stilgoe challenged you.
The rat.
Why can he pause for a laugh and the rest of us can't?
No,
also,
repetition
of Hose. No.
You could have had him on the other one as well, because one has to be fair, Richard, but you very cleverly got him on Hose instead, and you have half a second. Embarrassments, half a second, starting now.
Embarrassments.
Back with you to begin, Tim. The subject is Liszt. starting now.
I was once in a pub and a bloke came up to me and said, "You're Brahms and Liszt." I said, "No, I'm only one person. You must have got me confused with two other guys." This did not seem to satisfy him and he became rather aggressive. I turned to a companion of mine and said, "What is this bloke on about? Is he..."
Wendy, challenge.
Did we have two blokes there?
There were four of us in all, actually.
There were two blokes, but he repeated the word blokes, Wendy. Well, listen, and you have 45 seconds to tell us something about Liszt, starting now.
For several years, I played a character in I Being Served called Miss Brahms, and I believe that that name was chosen because it was supposed to go with Brahms and Liszt. Now, why the producer...
Peter Jones challenged.
Repetition of Brahms.
Brahms, yes.
Twice.
Yes, oh, yes. You played a character called Miss Brahms and the Brahms and Liszt.
Sorry.
Don't apologise, because Peter's delighted. He's got in and gained another point and 34 seconds to tell us something about Liszt, starting now.
Well, the only pictures I've ever seen of Liszt show him as a very old man. I wonder if there are any others or anybody has seen pictures of him when he was younger.
Richard Stilgoe, challenge.
Two pictures.
Oh, yes.
Yes, that's right, yes. I thought you were going to say yes, you had, Richard, but it doesn't really matter. 26 seconds for you to tell us something about Liszt, Richard, starting now.
Funnily enough, you're absolutely right, Peter, that the most famous picture of Liszt shows him sitting on a train with a wart on one side of his nose, and he has very long white hair, and he has a priest's hat on his head, because towards the end of his life, he took holy orders in the cloth. This was after having an enormous career as a concert pianist, playing the pieces for the piano is the word I was looking for.
Oh, dear me. The most obvious thing, but he had to search in the recesses of his mind, and it never came because Tim Rice challenged and got him with 5 seconds to go, Liszt starting now.
Playing the notes on his piano, which were A, B, C, D, E, F.
Those in the audience were saying, oh, any ploy is fair game in just a minute. Tim Rice, you've increased your lead. And Peter Jones, it's your turn to begin. Peter, the subject is leeks. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Leeks are, among other things, a very nice vegetable. Cooked, braised, I would suggest, rather than fried or cooked in water.
Wendy, Richard, challenge.
Two cooked.
There were two cooks. You were cooked twice, Peter.
Oh, yes.
And you cooked yourself, unfortunately. And Wendy got in with a sharp challenge with 52 seconds left on leeks, starting now.
I'm not a great fan of leeks. My husband's informed me he hates leeks. But whenever I make a stew, I always put leeks in, and it's so well cooked, he doesn't know he's eating leeks. So, you see, if you actually leave them in a pan for some number of hours, they gradually start to dissolve a bit, so you don't know what you're eating, and you are still getting all the goodness.
Peter Jones challenge.
She mentioned eating earlier.
Yes, yeah? You talked about your husband eating leeks.
Oh,
he doesn't like eating leeks.
No, he doesn't.
Yes, right, yes. Another point to you in 30 seconds, and the subject's back. Leeks starting now.
I was just thinking about Wendy's husband possibly listening to this, and he'll always know from now on that there's a high likelihood of leeks being in the dish that he's eating. Oh, he's here, is he? Oh, well, then it's all gone, blown. What about government leeks? Thinking in terms of dripping information to people, journalists, for instance.
Rice challenge.
I thought there were several errs there.
Yes, he was dripping away himself. You were really dripping away there.
Yes.
It wasn't your best moment, I don't think, in the show.
No, I haven't had a good moment for some time.
Tim, you have got in with 9 seconds on leaks, starting now.
I'm glad that Peter brought up government leaks because this is an extremely interesting topic and version of this subject. For starters...
For starters, pause. Wendy, yes?
Hesitation.
Hesitation, and you've cleverly got in with half a second to go. Leaks, starting now.
Leaks are the...
So, Wendy, you increased your position by moving forward ahead of Richard Stilgoe and Peter Jones, but you're still trailing 3 points behind our leader, Tim Rice. But it's your turn to begin, and the subject is lies. Can you tell us something about that? Starting now.
I think lies and the people who perpetrate them are one of the most appalling sins in life. To tell one lie, one must tell another to cover the first lie. I personally try never to tell lies unless I've put leeks in my husband's dinner. I try to fob it off as some other vegetable. But apart from that, I think that is called a white lie, which probably isn't so harmful. But other lies can do irreparable damage, or some other way of saying that word.
Tim Rice challenge.
Deviation.
Deviation in what a sense?
Well, there was a word there which I didn't understand.
So you're going to have deviation from standard English or recognisable,
yes,
intelligible English.
Yes, precisely.
And we'll give you that deviation. You'll have 26 seconds on lies starting now.
I have to disagree with my esteemed colleague because I think that lies can make the world go round. Occasionally, it is extremely important to have the odd whopper in your repertoire. You never know when something will hurt, and the truth can hurt often much more.
Peter Jones has challenged.
He said hurt twice.
Yes, you did hurt.
I did, yes.
Very concerned about hurting.
Well spotted, Peter.
Right, Peter, you got him with 8 seconds on lies, starting now.
Well, I agree, it's very important to have a whopper ready at any time, because you may be called upon to produce it and save somebody being hurt.
So, Peter Jones kept going to the whistle and gained that extra point. He's moved up 1 point behind Wendy Richards, who's 4 behind Tim Rice, and trailing Richard Stilgoe, who's going to begin the next round. Richard, the subject is My Lucky Number. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
The choice of lucky numbers available to people is absolutely enormous. Let me give you one or two examples. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8...
Tim Rice's challenge.
Deviation. He said one or two examples, and he's already given us 8.
A very clever challenge, Tim, yes. Yes, yes, a clever challenge. Thank goodness, otherwise he'd have gone on until 50 seconds up. So well done, Tim. Another point to you, and 47 seconds on My Lucky Number, starting now.
My lucky number is 28. That's really all I have to say on the matter, but I will...
Peter Jones got in.
If that's all he has to say, he should shut up. Don't worry.
He certainly paused, Peter, so you have 43 seconds to tell us something about My Lucky Number, starting now.
Before the war and in advance...
That was slight hesitation.
One of the longest errors we've had on the show, actually.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah.
Right. 40 seconds on with Wendy on My Lucky Number, starting now.
My Lucky...
Richard Jones, a challenge.
Too slow.
Yes. 39 seconds for you, Peter, My Lucky Number, starting now.
Before I was married.
Tim Rice challenge.
Two befores.
When was the other one?
Before the war, and now before he was married. There were two befores, or one but eight.
Tim, you've got in very sharply on My Lucky Number. 38 seconds left, starting now.
But there are things I can tell you about this gripping topic, which hadn't crossed my mind until I heard distinguished gentlemen such as Peter Jones.
To Andy Richards challenged.
It's a hesitation.
Yes, yes, I think almost, but enough to... a tough one, but we give it to you. 31 seconds on My Lucky Number, Wendy, starting now.
My lucky numbers are various, and I put them all down on my football pools every week. They are, in fact, number 28, number 13... 32, 19, 27, some others I've forgotten. But it's a fun...
Peter Jones challenged.
She's forgotten them. So she can't go on giving us any more.
Well, it doesn't matter, Peter, she's forgotten them. She's still keeping going on the subject.
Oh, I see, yes. Yeah.
Wendy, that was an incorrect challenge, so you've still got the subject. 16 seconds, My Lucky Number, starting now.
I've forgotten what I was saying now, but...
Peter Jones challenged.
There you are, you see, she's forgotten. No.
So that is deviation. 15 seconds for you, Peter, on My Lucky Number, starting now.
It was a telephone number, and whenever I rang it, I was lucky. Well, before the war...
Took a long time for everybody to wake up that you'd...
Oh, I know, yeah.
Richard Stilgoe, you got in first. Well, got in first, I mean, you got in at last. And there are 4 seconds left on My Lucky Number, starting now.
You haven't asked me what I was challenging about. Oh, all right, I won't tell you what I was challenging.
Nobody challenged you for deviation, because what even asked me what I'm challenging got nothing to do with the subject. But they didn't, and so, Richard, you were still speaking when the whistle went. Tim, we're back with you to begin. The subject is Son et Lumière. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Son et Lumière can be an example of theatre at its finest. As I'm sure everybody listening knows, son is the French for sound, et lumière is the French...
Richard Stilgoe challenged.
A repetition of French.
Yes, that's right, yes. And, of course, if he kept going, he might have done it with such aplomb they may not have picked it up. But, Richard, he paused, you picked him up, and you have 48 seconds to tell us something about Son et Lumière, starting now.
Sonny Lumière was one of the greatest French jazz guitarists who ever lived. The whole of the Lumière family learnt this instrument, and they played it with varying degrees of success around the clubs in which that particular sort of music is performed all over the nation, whose name I may well have said, but I'm not going to say it again, just in case I have said it before. Sonny Lumière was...
And Peter Jones challenged.
He said it before twice, said it before.
Peter, you have 26 seconds on Sonny Lumière, starting now.
Do they in France call it sound and light, I wonder? I think it's usually pretty dreary, and it's often raining when it takes place. And altogether, any experience I've had of Sonny Lumière has been unhappy and damp. Well, they have historical figures...
Just don't challenge you on the damp.
No, was that an damp? Was it a hesitation between and damp, or is that
Not enough to be a real hesitation. Otherwise...
I think one of the reasons I'm doing so badly is that Peter holds his buzzer completely differently from me.
Well...
I'll try it holding it like that, and we'll see if we do any better.
Well, how were you holding it, Richard?
Holding it like that. This is great fun for listeners at home. and Peter's holding it like that.
Yeah, but you're holding it as though you're going to blow the bloody place up.
Any moment now.
Hello.
That was some of the finest radio we've had. So we'll carry on with Sonny Lumière, and I disagree with your challenge, by the way, Richard.
So do
Peter
I.
keeps the subject, another point to him, and there are 11 seconds left, starting now.
Sometimes they have a narrator booming out over the tannoy, describing what these other people are doing, dressed up as historical characters and so on, actors usually employed in this way. Well...
Peter Jones, then speaking as the whistle went, gained that all-important extra point, and we've reached a very interesting situation, because Peter has now leapt forward. He's equal in the lead with Tim Rice. A little way behind is Wendy Richard, and then comes Richard Stilgoe, and we have time for one more subject, and Peter, it's your turn to begin. The subject is making a fortune. Can you tell us something about that? With 60 seconds to go, starting now.
Well, somebody once told me, ages ago, when I was just starting out in my career, that if I wanted to make a small fortune, the best thing to do would be to possess a large one, and it would be quite easy. Now, that's a kind of joke, I suppose, but there's a lot of truth in it. It's quite a sort of...
Tim Rice challenge.
I think there was a bit of hesitation
there. There was hesitation there, Tim. I agree with you. So you get another point. And you have 42 seconds to tell us something about making a fortune, and who better, starting now.
You need discipline, hard work, guts, drive, talent, vigour, and a gun.
Wendy, you challenge. He dried up after the vigour.
It was a dramatic pause for effect.
Yeah. Well, cancel my challenge then.
It was definitely a pause. He thought of all the things that had gone into making his fortune, and then he paused. And you got in with a correct challenge, Wendy, and you have 35 seconds to tell us something about making a fortune, starting now.
The trouble is, a lot of people who don't understand our profession think that one is making a fortune, but in fact, you're not. You do have to work very hard for whatever fortune, small or big or large or even larger, might come your way. It is not easy by any means, and one has to look round for all sorts of employment to hopefully bring in this large fortune.
Tim Rice challenged.
Split infinitive.
How dare you? What do you mean I've got split infinitive?
I thought you were struggling,
Wendy. Split,
I thought she wanted to be eased away from the topic. No. She seemed uncomfortable.
She might have looked as if she did, but also I'm sure she'd like to win points and try and overtake you, because you can split your infinitives as long as you keep going without hesitation, repetition or deviation. She is all right. So, Wendy, you're now 2 points behind Tim Rice, and there are 8 seconds left. Making a fortune, starting now.
I've been struggling for nearly 31 years to make a fortune. Hopefully, I will achieve...
Peter Jones' challenge.
My advice would be for her to give in.
Isn't it awful how the audience always applaud the wicked challenges? Peter, obviously the audience enjoy that challenge so much, we give you a bonus point for the challenge. But we leave the subject with Wendy, who gets a point for being interrupted. 2 seconds left, making a fortune, starting now.
Actually, I don't really want a big fortune. I think just...
And nobody picked up on the word big, which he used before... But it did leave us with a very interesting situation at the end of the show. Richard Stilgoe, playing the game for the very first time, did magnificently, didn't he, ladies and gentlemen? Yes. That solo applause, Richard, is to compensate for the fact that you're in fourth place. Not many points behind our leaders. All three finished with the same number of points. Oh. Peter Jones, Wendy Richard and Tim Rice are three joint... today. A very fair result, because I always say it's what they contribute is far more important than the points they gain. It only remains for me to say, on behalf of our four talented panelists, Richard Stilgoe, Peter Jones, Wendy Richard and Tim Rice, and Ling, who's kept the score, the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and our producer, Edward Taylor, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, thanks for tuning in, and we hope that you'll tune in again next time we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the Minute Waltz fades away once more, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the four personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We have Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Paul Merton and Clement Freud, and will you please welcome all four of them? The creator of the game, Ian Messiter, usually sits beside me, but unfortunately he can't be with us this week. So once again, I'm fortunate in having with me the lovely Anne Ling, who will keep the score, and she will blow the whistle when the full 60 seconds are up. And once more, I'm going to ask our four panellists to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation or repetition or deviating from the subject on the card. Let us begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, the subject, graffiti. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Graffiti comes from the Latin word to scratch, graffito, and was first used when the ruins in Pompeii, and indeed Rome, and later Herculaneum were discovered. And they discovered upon the walls the most filthy scratch bits of paper, all kinds of vulgarities, ruderies, mostly obscene and sexual. I don't really think it's the sort of thing we ought to be talking about here, but you will.
Clement Freud has challenged you.
He repeated discovered some time ago.
Clement, well listened. You get a point for a correct challenge. You take over the subject of graffiti. There are 33 seconds left, starting now.
In the public convenience at Oban, which is on the west coast of Scotland, there is one of the most entertaining graffito that I have come across. Written upon the wall are the words, "Will the gentleman who got off the bus from Stranraer on the 14th of October, 1983, and whom I met here and took back to meet my wife, please be good enough, should he come past this location on another occasion, to call and see the aforementioned woman, because she has certainly formed a sort of attachment to him," and I thought the whistle would blow by now.
I will be honest, Clement, we did let it go beyond the 60 seconds because I wasn't sure whether this was the whole of the graffito that you referred to or whether you were making it up. We now suspect you were making some of it up, but you did extraordinarily well. You kept going until the whistle went, which was 11 seconds over time, and you gain a bonus point for speaking as the whistle went, and at the end of that round you are, of course, in the lead, and it is your turn to begin. The subject, peanuts. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
We went some months ago to the Gambia, which is totally self-sufficient on peanuts. It is the only thing in which it has a sufficiency. I should think it was probably the slave trade which brought peanuts from Brazil to that coast of Africa. I've seen Africa before.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Revolution of Africa.
Yes, you did say Africa before, so Derek's got in with 37 seconds on peanuts, starting now.
Well, peanuts are what the British Broadcasting Corporation to choose to pay us for appearing on this programme. And we have done this for some 23 years because we greatly enjoy entertaining the public arts. I do stutter, I stutter. What a
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation from known English language.
Denoy, yes, or whatever the word was. Right, Paul, you have a correct challenge. You have a point. You had 24 seconds on peanuts, starting now.
Peanuts is the name of a cartoon strip created by Charles Schultz, an American...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Well, I suppose that slurring of words could be interpreted as hesitation,
I couldn't
Peter.
Remember his name as soon as I started.
I think you did jolly well as you sort of keep going through this until it came out. Peter, you have the subject of peanuts and 17 seconds starting now.
Well, Paul was quite right. It was invented by this man, Schultz, and he is one of the richest cartoonists in the world. I believe he employs now a lot of other people to do the drawings and still more to think of the ideas. I've never really been very amused by these pictures that I've seen.
So Peter Jones was then speaking as the whistle went, and he got that all-important extra point, so he's now in second place at the end of the round. Clement Freud's still in the lead. Peter, will you take the next round? The subject, indoor sports. Will you tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now?
Well, some of the best indoor sports can be played with great pleasure outside, out of doors. And whenever I am in a secluded place, in a forest or on a beach that has very few people on it, I never forget to take my bat and ball with me, and I play it wherever I am, with whomsoever I might be with.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Well, deviation is talking solely about outdoor sports.
No, I'm talking about indoor sports played outdoors.
I think he did establish...
That's not what we're supposed to talk about.
But it doesn't matter. I think he established that these were indoor sports, and he was playing them out of doors, but they were still indoor sports. Peter keeps the subject, having gained a point, with 37 seconds on his indoor sports, starting now.
Ping pong is one of the best indoor sports, in my opinion, sometimes called table tennis by the professionals and people who take it more seriously. And I wonder...
Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I think so. In fact, I'm certain of it. 26 seconds for you, Clement, on indoor sports, starting now.
In the town of Oban, which is on the west coast of Scotland, there is a tremendous lot of indoor sport goes on. And I came across a couple of games of snooker which were being played simultaneously to darts, table tennis, which Peter Jones calls ping pong, although professionals tend to call it the former. On Tuesday, the 14th of April,
Oh, Clement Freud kept going with his indoor sports till the whistle wind gained an extra point and has increased his lead. Paul Merton, will you take the next round? The subject is diet fads. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
There are many kinds of diet fads. People seem to think that if they drink nothing but water, they will lose weight, and they will. They will also die after about 56 days. And then you lose a hell of a lot of weight once you're dead. Your body decomposes completely, and you...
Derek challenged.
Well, he Derek stopped, didn't he, really?
I started to make myself laugh, which you is a bad move.
You all make different noises when you come to us all to a sticky end like that. Derek, you got in on diet fads, and there are 43 seconds left, starting now.
One of the most interesting diet fads I encountered on Oban on the west coast of Scotland. There they eat solely a diet of cockaleeky soup, non-stop, for 48 days, and at the end of that, they're violently sick and lose all the weight that they might have put on. I think perhaps the narcissist is drinking lemon juice.
Merton's challenge.
This is just nonsense. This is deviation. People are listening to this. They might be tempted to go out and buy some tins of cockaleeky soup and they won't lose weight. They'll just die because they won't get enough protein.
So I give you the benefit of the doubt, Paul, and you have 18 seconds to take over diet fads, starting now.
Another popular diet fad is bran. A lot of people eat this form of roughage because they know it's good for the digestive system, and it's also useful to eat this particular kind of food stuff because it is very good to help you...
Clement Freud got in.
There was an
And you only had 1 second to go. Too soon. So Clement got in with 1 second on diet fads, starting now. And Paul Burton challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes. So, Paul, you've got half a second on diet fads, starting now.
Bran is...
So Paul Merton, surprisingly, was speaking then when the whistle went. And Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is painters. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
The United Kingdom didn't really produce any good portrait painters until the 18th century. Holbein, Van Dyck, people like that, came from overseas to paint in this country. Then...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. The United Kingdom did produce portrait painters before that because the caves that then during the Stone Age are full
you're
of portraits.
You're pushing your luck on that one, mate.
And in fact, if you go to Oban in Scotland, you see cubicle free from the left, there's a very nice antelope on the door.
Yeah. No, I think the point that... Derek is making is justified, so we leave the subject with
him. Are we talking only about British painters?
I don't know until you get the subject, Peter. It just says painters is the subject.
Yes, I see.
Nice to have you with us again, Peter. Derek Nimmo has got it at the moment, and there are 48 seconds to tell us something about painters, starting now.
Monet, Manet, Pizarro, Picasso... Those are some of the foreign painters that Peter Jones would like to hear about. There are, however, some of the most wonderful paintings in the world in the Uffizi Gallery in Florence. If you ever witness Botticelli's Venus rising from the sea, you will get absolutely agape at the sheer beauty of that which you behold.
Paul Merton has challenged.
Deviation. It's impossible to witness it. You can see the picture. But you can't witness Venus coming out of the sea.
No. You can experience it. You can feel it. A very clever challenge. You certainly can't witness it. That's what happens when they have to keep going and they use colloquialisms, and therefore that is deviation. Well done, Paul. 21 seconds on painters, starting now.
My father was a painter. He painted the back shed in the garden several coats of white, which was...
Clement Freud's
challenge. Repetition.
What?
Several coats of white.
But it was over the course of 35 years.
Yeah. And he came from Oban, did he?
He did, yes.
Well, what we do is we give Clement Freud a bonus point because we'd all enjoyed the challenge, but Paul Merton wasn't deviating from the actual rules of Just a Minute. He keeps the subject and gets a point for the interruption. 15 seconds are left on painters starting now.
Around the beginning of the turn of this century, there was a movement in art...
Peter Jones challenge.
When exactly is the beginning of the turn?
The beginning of the turn of the century.
Yes. Right. When did it start to turn?
New Year's Eve, 1900.
Paul, you've still got the subject and 11 seconds, another point, and painters starting now.
A movement that was described...
Derek Nimmo.
A movement.
What's that?
Repetition movement.
So 9 seconds, you are correct, Derek, and painters with you starting now.
Jean-Baptiste Tiepolo, Rembrandt, Rubens, and Van Gogh were names that come to my mind when I'm trying to think of painters. Other ones that I would like to mention are...
So, they all had a good go on painters and all gained points in the round. The situation is that Clement Freud is still in the lead. He's just ahead of Paul Merton. And Clement Freud, your turn to begin the subject, Ballyhoo. Would you like to tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
William Shakespeare wrote a play which should have been called Quite a Lot of Ballyhoo Concerning Not Much. But instead, he named it Much Ado About Nothing, and it has been...
A Paul Merton challenged.
Repetition of much...
Yes, much ado, and it has much. Well, listen, Paul, and you've got him with another point. 45 seconds, Ballyhoo, starting now.
Ballyhoo, I suppose, is something that is described... Oh, I don't know. I'm not interested in it at all, really.
It's a lot of ballyhoo, isn't it? Right, Clement, you got him with a challenge. I should hear what it was, which is...
Well, almost everything.
I think you've got to select one. Let's see if I agree.
It's deviation from the way we like to play this game.
I think everybody enjoyed that. Perhaps I shouldn't give it to you on that. No, I think we'll give it to you on the hesitation. All right, Clement, 41 seconds on Ballyhoo, starting now.
Ballyhoo was a pretty competent 4-year-old hurdler who won at Liverpool the entry racecourse in 1981, and I was there. I put some money on him at 100-8 and added more at 10-1. The winnings, I remember well, were called the Ballyhoo fortune in the Freud family, and we went out and had dinners, suppers, breakfasts and luncheons. We visited theatres and operas, cinemas and...
Paul Merton challenge.
This is just boasting.
He may be boasting, but it's not one of the rules.
I know.
You could have maybe had him for deviation, but you didn't, so we. Clement Freud has another point, and Ballyhoo, 2 seconds, starting now.
A son of Ballyhoo then ran the Jutoxica.
So Clement Freud, again speaking as the whistle went, has again increased his lead. And Peter Jones, your turn to begin. The subject, Ali Baba. Would you tell us something about him?
Well, it could be quite dangerous, I suppose. There are probably lots of people in the Middle East called Ali Baba, and they might have it in for me if I say something that isn't flattering.
Derek Nimmo.
Hesitation.
There was a hesitation. There was an there. I'm sorry, Peter.
There was, yes.
Yeah, yes, there definitely
yes,
was.
Yes, I actually heard it.
I think... It's so wonderful when you listen, Peter, because you're always such yes, great exactly. value to the show.
Yes.
51 seconds for you, Derek, on Ali Baba, starting now.
Ali Baba was a 4-year-old gelding that I found in a toaster in March this year. Also, of course, one thinks that wonderful story from the Arabian Nights of Ali Baba who followed this robber band back to their cave and overheard them saying, "Open sesame!" And this great boulder thundered and they...
And Paul Merton challenge.
This is deviation, I might be wrong, but isn't Open Sesame Aladdin?
That's right, yes.
No, it's but, not. It's Ali Baba, too.
Is it Ali Baba? Yeah,
that's where it originally
I've only
came.
Done Cinderella and Babes in the Wood. And,
but you're always in a frock anyway.
The audience seem to think that you're correct about Open Sesame, so is he right, audience?
Yes.
All right, well, it's on your... Because, you know, this does go all round the world, this show, and there'll be people writing in.
Well,
you know,
it has up to now.
They want to know that our traditional pantomimes are played correctly. Derek, you have 28 seconds on Alibaba, starting now.
He was entered in July meeting at Goodwood on the Thursday, which is, of course, the most...
Clement Freud, Charlie.
Deviation.
Why?
No horse that runs a toaster over the sticks could be entered in a July meeting at Goodwood.
You can run a toaster...
On the flat.
Not always over the sticks, a toaster.
Yes, always.
22 seconds on Alibaba, Clement, starting now.
Frankly, I always preferred the 40 Thieves to Alibaba. I thought they were more gracious, generous...
Derek Nimmo...
Hesitation.
Yes, I think there was a hesitation after the graciousness. 15 seconds back with you, Derek, on Alibaba, starting now.
I played Alibaba when I was with No. 9 Signal Regiment in Cyprus some years ago. My chief robber, in fact, was Sir Peter Miller, as he now is, chairman of Lloyd's, and I thought that was very suitable that he should get that particular job that he's got now.
Peter Jones has challenged you.
He's not talking about Alibaba. He's talking about this other geezer who has something to do with a bank.
Yes. Talked about him being suitable, I agree with you, Peter. That was deviation.
Talking about my production of it.
Peter, you've got him with 1 second to go on Alibaba, starting now.
He was never a horse.
Well, it's a very close contest this week. For those interested in the score, and I know there are always some, Clement Freud is still in the lead, then he's followed by Derek Nimmo, and then Paul Merton, and then Peter Jones, but only about 1 or 2 points separate any of them. Paul Merton, we're back with you to begin, and the subject is Boggling. Will you tell us something about Boggling in just a minute, starting now?
Boggling was a 4-year-old filly that ran in the 1898 Derby, and unfortunately it didn't do.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Fillies don't run in the Derby.
Clement is correct, and he's got Boggling with 55 seconds to go, starting now.
Boggling is a state where your eyes pop out more than other people's, so that you...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, he hesitated as soon as his eyes popped out. And there are 49 seconds for you, Derek, on Boggling, starting now.
I was sitting in a lavatory and opened my mind absolutely boggled at what I saw, because there was Sir Clement Freud, who works for the tourist board of that particular city, and mentioned it whenever possible, standing outside, waiting his turn to come in. It was the most boggling sight you can ever imagine. One time I was playing
Paul
in Canberra.
Paul Merton has challenged you.
Deviation. I can think of more boggling things than Clement Freud waiting outside a public lavatory.
Very personal.
I don't know. It sounds mind-boggling to me.
Really?
But 29 seconds. I give you the benefit of the doubt, Derek. Boggling, starting now.
It was a game that the old drovers played in the old days when they were coming into...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of old.
Yes, you had a bit of old in before. So you got it in this time correctly, Paul, and you have 26 seconds to tell us something about Boggling, starting now.
Boggling was a horse that ran...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of horse.
You said, used the word horse.
I said
before.
Filly before.
Filly last time
no, you said a filly. 3-year-old filly, Clement. There are 23 seconds on Boggling, starting now.
And my great-grandfather put a rather enormous amount of money on this particular four-legged animal.
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of four.
Four-year-old filly and four-legged horse. Oh, bad luck, Paul. So you can't win in this game. 16 seconds on Boggling, Clement, starting now.
The sort of thing that would make me boggle would be if a 4-year-old filly ran in the Derby. It is the most astonishing concept that female equine animals run at Epsom round Tattenham Corner against horses of...
So Clement Freud was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point and has increased his lead. We're back with Derek Nimmo to begin. The subject, Derek, is covens.
A coven consists of 13 creatures, 12 witches, and the devil itself. Covens used to meet on certain saint days, particularly, of course, All Hallows' Eve, and at Lammermass and Michaelmas. When they gathered together, they...
Paul Merton challenge.
He lost the will to live. Hesitation.
Hesitation, Paul. Well done. And there are 41 seconds for you to tell us something about Covens starting now.
My father made a lot of money on a horse called Covens, which ran in the 1927 Derby. And with that cash, he decided to set up a coven of his own. He invited all the neighbours around, and they had a black satanic mass, including the woman at number 47, and they dressed up totally...
Derek never started.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was an there, and Derek's got another point, and the subject, and 20 seconds on covens starting now.
These evil crones used to have on their broomsticks with them cats, which were called their familiars, because it was believed that they had an extra nipple to feed the beast with. Extraordinary thought. But until 1540...
Oh, Clement, you challenge.
Hesitation.
Clement, you're in with 6 seconds on coven starting now.
A coven is an assembly of witches who sit around a cauldron wondering what...
Again, Clement Freud was speaking as the whistle went. Again, increased his lead, but he's closely followed by Derek Nimmo, and then 1 point behind Paul Merton, and then two or three behind him is Peter Jones. And Clement Freud, your turn to begin. The subject, Hey Presto.
Hey Presto is the sort of thing that you might say if you put turnips, carrots and potatoes into an oven, opened it, and found a chocolate mousse. Witches and magicians use Hey Presto quite a lot in order to...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. I don't think witches use Hey Presto.
No,
a magician
no.
uses it because he's in the business of trying to deceive the public, where witches are trying to summer up the dark forces
Keep
of the universe.
For the program.
Yes.
I think you made an extraordinarily good case, and I'm sure the audience is entirely with you, and so am I, so you have 42 seconds.
I was very pleased that it didn't turn out to be another horse.
So, Paul Merton, Hey Presto, 42 seconds, starting now.
Hey Presto is something you might hear from a magician rather than a witch, because a witch is somebody who...
Oh, Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two witches.
Two witches. 35 seconds for you, Derek. No, 36 on Hey Presto, starting now.
So I ran to the middle of the main street in Canberra and banged my top hat with my magic wand and said, Hey Presto, and out came a lovely little bunny, White Rabbit. People were so thrilled and pleased because in the Antipodes they love magic. And they...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, in the first place, I don't believe that it happened. And in the second place, people in Australia would not be thrilled and delighted at the sight of a rabbit.
I'm sure you're absolutely right, Peter. So we give you the subject of Hey Presto, and there are 23 seconds starting now.
I wish I could say Hey Presto and a taxi would arrive outside to take me home. But I must hang on for another hour or so, and then I shall go home and say...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of home.
Yeah, you mentioned your home.
Oh, yes, I'm a great home lover. I can't help thinking about it all the time.
What worried me was the fact that you're going to hang around here for another hour or so, because the show's going to be over in a few minutes, actually. I've just got a note that this is about the round after this will be the last round.
Oh, really?
Mm. Ah, Kevin Floyd, you have 13 seconds to tell us something about Hey Presto starting now.
There are a very limited number of professions who are entitled to use the expression Hey Presto, and I would like to name some from whom this is withheld. Parsons.
Clement, you were speaking again as the whistle went, and again, not surprisingly, you gained an extra point, and not surprisingly, you've increased your lead, and we're now into the last round, and it's Peter Jones' turn to begin, and the subject, Peter... Oh, you won't believe this. It's hope. So, will you talk on the subject starting now?
Faith, hope, and charity. And the greatest of these is charity.
Too much charity. Let it begin at home, I think.
You should have changed the quote and made it hope.
What?
You repeated charity.
Oh, did I?
Yeah.
Yes, I was so carried away by the great theme of it all.
You should have said, and the greatest of these...
Yes.
should have been hope, and then we went back.
Yes, of course, I should have stopped. I never know when to stop, you see, that's the trouble.
Derek Nimmo had a correct challenge, and he got in first, and so he takes the subject with 55 seconds on hope, starting now.
Faith, hope, and love, as described in the New English Bible, comes from 13th Corinthians, the letter that St. Paul wrote to the people of that fair city. But I would like to talk about the hope diamond. Have you ever seen it, ladies and gentlemen? You probably haven't, but I did look at this great stone, the Hope Rock, and was I impressed? 342.5 carats. Is that not enormous? And who discovered it? I ask you, Mr. Jones. Not Peter, alas, but a fellow working in the mines in South Africa who came across by poking an umbrella into the side of the rock, and there was this nugget.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of rock.
You talked change. About the diamond.
Yes, all right. Rock.
Instead of saying the hope diamond, you said the rock, and Clement got in with 9 seconds on hope, starting now.
I really...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, well done, Peter. There's always hope, you see, Peter, and you have 9 seconds left. Oh,
it must have been a hell of a hesitation.
Actually, it should be 8 seconds for hope, starting now.
Hope springs eternal in the human breast. And I must say that this applies to me as well as everyone else. We are all brothers.
So Peter Jones, speaking on hope, brought this particular show, or this particular edition of Just a Minute, to an end, and also he gained an extra point at that moment, but he still finished, alas, in fourth place. The man who gained most points for his clever performance in this show was Clement Freud, so we say he is the winner this week. Hope that you've enjoyed this particular edition of Just a Minute, and it only remains for me to say, on behalf of our four excellent panellists, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Clement Freud and Paul Merton, and also Anne Ling, who's kept the score, and also Ian Messer, who created the game, and our producer, Edward Taylor, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, thank you for tuning in, and we hope you'll all be with us again the next time we play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye! Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four exciting and talented personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud, Paul Merton, and we also welcome for the first time playing the game, Sandy Toksvig. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits the charming Anne Ling with a stopwatch to keep the seconds ticking away and a whistle in the other hand, which she blows when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I will ask our four competitors if they can speak on the subject which I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. Let us begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, the subject is China. I'm sure it's been chosen specially for a travelling man like you, but will you talk on the subject starting now?
The Middle Kingdom, the centre of the universe, home to a quarter of the world's population, over a billion people. The Qing dynasty, the Ming of the same variety, reigned for 300 years between them. I was standing in Tiananmen Square only 2 weeks ago, and there I looked at the Temple of the Heavenly Gate before proceeding into the Forbidden City. When you see the Great Wall, which is the only man-made edifice which can be seen from the moon, you realise how vast that extraordinary place of China is, the amount that we owe to it. And then, of course, Dewsbury China, I like very much, came from the Derby factory. 1965, he moved up from Chelsea and Bow, and some of the moulds that they've got there, I think, of exquisite beauty, modelled very often on Johann
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of beauty.
Yes, there was beauty. There was extreme beauty about...
I'm all right.
I know, but you always look as if you're trying to bluff me out of it.
I was just looking at you with total contempt.
Isn't it amazing the way I've put up with it for 23 years, too, Derek? Anyway, no one believes that we're friends.
Certainly not me.
Clement, you have cleverly got in with 2 seconds to go with a correct challenge, so you get a point for that, and you take over the subject of China starting now.
Burslem Stoke Stone in Staffordshire. Good.
Just to remind anybody who may be hearing the show for the first time, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, and it was Clement Freud who was the only one to have scored in that round. Paul Merton, will you take the next round? The subject, the thing in the cellar. That is the subject. Will you talk on it in this game starting now?
Nicholas Parsons has a portrait of himself in his own cellar. While this picture is rapidly ageing, the young, youthful chairman that we see in front of us, still in the spring of his adult life, a wonderful example to young people today after 70 years in show...
Derek Nimmo has a chance.
Deviation is not a wonderful example to young people.
That's a rotten challenge.
You ought to be in a twilight home.
Paul, it was an incorrect challenge. You have a point for that. 45 seconds to continue on the thing in the cellar, starting now.
I've had this thing in the cellar now for about 7 or 8 years. It makes a kind of strange gurgling noise late at night, and I've asked the council to come round and investigate it, and they've said, frankly, it's nothing to do with us. You'll have to ask a ghostbuster or some kind of paranormal scientist to investigate this phenomenon deep down in your cellar. So one night I decided to go down and investigate it for myself. And what I found was a quivering mass of jelly-like...
Sandy Toksvig, you've challenged.
I don't know, I'm just guessing, but I think repetition on investigator.
Absolutely right. Well done. Council asked to investigate, and then he went down to investigate.
What a lot of investigating. I didn't believe him, though. I don't believe the council went to investigate anything. I think that's a lot of nonsense.
Well, you could have had him for deviation, you see.
I could have had him for a lot of things, but I haven't got time.
Sandy, you have the subject, the first time to speak on Just a Minute. The best of luck to you. There are 16 seconds left. The subject is The Thing in the Cellar, starting now. And Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Rather mean hesitation, I'm afraid.
Yes. Yeah. You're absolutely disgraceful.
I know, I was just sort of trigger-happy. I'm totally sorry. Just,
I disagree long years entirely, Derek. So, Sandy, you have another point for an incorrect challenge, but do start a bit quicker next time. And,
sorry.
There are 14 seconds on The Thing in the Cellar, starting now.
We've got a thing in our cellar.
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
She started very quickly.
Pleasing some men, you start slowly, you start quickly.
What I want to know...
It's always the woman's fault, have you noticed?
Give them both a point. And Sandy, there are 13 seconds left for The Thing in the Cellar, starting now.
We've got a thing in our cellar, and it's my grandfather. He's been going off for some time now. I think it's his feet, they're gangrenous. He got that by standing in trenches in France. There was no war going on, he just liked to go and dig trenches in France.
Clement Freud challenge.
Trenches.
There were too many trenches he stood in, I'm afraid.
I think that's what it was, yeah.
I know. And Clement's got in with 1 second to go. Again, The Thing in the Cellar, Clement, starting now. And Paul Benton,
hesitation.
Yes, absolutely. And you've got half a second on the thing in the cellar, Paul, starting now.
Salt is the main thing.
So at the end of that round, Paul Merton was speaking as a whistle wind, got the extra point, but he's only in second place, equal with Sandy Toksvig. And Clement Freud, it is your turn to begin. The subject, impossibilities. That sounds a nice subject. Will you talk on it in this game, starting now?
Impossibilities is a plural word which you very seldom find in the singular form of impossibility. But I'm going to talk about it. It means something which you are unlikely to be able to do, like mountaineer in Cambridgeshire, or teach a fish to ride a bicycle. Among impossibilities would be Nicholas Parsons to make a really good joke.
Sandy Toksvig.
Hesitation.
What?
Hesitation, and also it's not fair to you, Nicholas.
Well, that was just what I thought you were going to challenge on.
I was mainly going to challenge on the unfairness to you and also the great chasm of hesitation that built up there.
No, there was no hesitation, but it was definitely deviation.
Oh, right.
Yes, that's right.
It was one of those shins, anyway.
Yeah, that's right. So, Sandy, you have another point, and you have the subject. You have 33 seconds on impossibilities, starting now.
One of the impossible things to do is to start quickly enough to please most men. What you have to do is to get right in there very, very quickly. But you can't really be...
Very Nimmo challenged.
Too quickly.
Very, very quickly. It's a tough game, isn't it? Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have 26 seconds on impossibilities, starting now.
They always say that one of the most impossible things is to stop a subscription to Reader's Digest. And I do agree, because somehow they bombard you with letters, giving you offers of all kinds of wealth and motor cars and Porsches if you will only renew the subscription to that indifferent...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two subscriptions.
There was another subscription, yes. It was like Reader's Digest, you know, more than one subscription. So, Clement, you're back in with the subject you started with. There are 10 seconds left. Impossibilities starting now.
It is a mark of insincerity of purpose to seek an emperor in a low-down tea shop is the sort of impossible remark you find in Chinese books which Nimmo...
Clement Freud once more was speaking as the whistle went and has increased his lead at the end of the round. Sandy Toksvig, it's your turn to begin. The subject is trends. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
There is an unpleasant trend or fashion at the moment for the anthropomorphosis of unnatural objects, inanimate items and animals into items for creatures of... I've no idea, really, what I'm saying here.
You actually had the audience agog. They thought you
did
know what
I said. Yes, for one moment there, I was quite taken away myself. Trouble is, I was listening when I was talking.
I know. It's fatal, isn't it? Yes. Derek, you challenge. What is your challenge?
Deviation, because you stopped.
Yes, right. So, Derek, you have a point for that. You have 49 seconds to tell us something about trends starting now.
One of the most fascinating trends in recent years was the acquisition of what was known as bondage. I met somebody who actually asked me to be strapped with leather things between my legs.
Sandy Toksvig was challenged.
Deviation. I'm sorry, I just can't bear to hear about it. That's all. I mean, it's all right on radio, but he's actually demonstrating next to me. So my challenge is that it was a sexual deviation.
May I, however, be allowed to point out to the audience, the radio audience at home, that I was actually demonstrating between my own legs.
Yeah. But as he wasn't contravening the rules of just a minute, Derry gets a point for being interrupted, and he continues with 35 seconds on trends starting
this
now.
This demonstration I received in the King's Road from somebody called Johnny Rotten. Remember also going to New Brighton, which is in the Wirral Peninsula, where there was an extraordinary trend for wearing inverted top hats. Now, that may sound peculiar to them, but actually, in those years, just after the war, there was an abundance of that aforementioned form of hattery because it had just gone out of fashion.
Sandy,
no longer
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. Is there such a word as hattery?
Oh, well, you can make up words, I imagine, as long as you don't deviate.
Oh, we can make up words, then, can we? I can't wait till it's my turn, then.
So you were having deviation of grammar then, or
deviation
of correct English.
Oh,
well, that's
language.
All right. I thought it was a repetition of the word hat, because he did repeat the word hat. But yes, it's a deviation from correct English. So hattery doesn't exist in the Oxford English Dictionary, which is our Bible here. And
it does.
What's that?
It does.
Does it?
Yes.
Oh, well, can you produce it next week and show me? And then I'll give you a bonus point for the next show that you appear in, Derek. In the meantime, I give 5 seconds to Paul Merton to continue... No, to take over trends, starting now.
One of the great trends of the early 1990s has proved to be mutant ninja hero...
Merton was speaking then as the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so. He's equal in second place with Sandy Toksvig. Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the pyramids. Will you tell us something about them in this game starting now?
By using the definite article, it does suggest there are only one lot of pyramids. Of course, there are many numbers of pyramids throughout the world.
And Clement Freud challenged.
There was sort of hesitation.
Yes, it was. Yeah. Stumbling over his words, we interpret that as hesitation. Clement, so you get in with a sharp challenge after only 5 seconds. 55 less left for the pyramids, starting now.
A pyramid is the sincerest form of hattery. It's a... it's a polygamal base.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Deviation. Hattery doesn't appear in the Oxford...
So you've got that point back that you wanted, Derek. So 47 seconds for you on the pyramids. Justice has been seen to be done, and you start now.
Of course, one normally thinks of Lower Egypt, those great pyramids at Saqqara or Giza. And the first one was actually designed by an architect whose name we know, Imhotep. Extraordinary. 5,000 years for the pharaoh Zosa. And it was a number of 6 actually diminishing squares placed on one on the other. And it was called the step pyramid. What's the matter now? For goodness sake, stop fussing around.
Actually.
What?
The third, actually. I let the first two.
Yes, he let the first two go. He was very sporting. You said actually 3 times.
I always say actually.
No, but you can't say it 3 times in just a minute, otherwise you lose the subject and the person who challenged gets a point. It was Clement Freud, 25 seconds, the pyramids. Clement, starting now.
Pyramid selling is the sort of thing that goes on a lot now. It means that ever more people have diminishing commission because too many other folk jump on the bandwagon. If you were to sell Reader's Digest subscriptions, for instance, by pyramid, it would mean that not only Derek Nimmo, but also Nicholas Parsons and Paul Merton, and probably in the end even I, would jump on this device.
Troy kept going for a long time on pyramids until the whistle went and gained an extra point for doing so, and he's now in a strong lead at the end of that round. Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject is moose. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I love moose. Strawberry moose, raspberry moose, chocolate moose. I can't get enough of it. In fact, I could eat moose all day if it wasn't bad for me. I went into a shop once and I said to the stockkeeper, I said, I will buy every single moose that you have in this store. And I carried away 657 items of moose. It was wonderful. That kept me going for at least 4 days, people say to me. You eat far too much moose. I said,
and Sandy talks for his chum.
Of eat.
Right, and Sandy, we're listening well. So she got in with 37 seconds left. Moose is the subject, Sandy, starting now.
I tend to put moose in my hair, which is very difficult as it's a large Canadian animal. I go to the zoo and I say, have you got any moose? And they say, certainly, madam, that'll be...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of say.
I know, what another tough challenge. It's a difficult game, isn't it, Sandy? Mm. Derek got in, 28 seconds on moose, starting now.
The largest form of elk, and they have the most magnificent antlers. I used to stay near Rotorua in New Zealand at a house called Moose Lodge, belonging to somebody called Sir Noel and Lady Cole. He was a distinguished architect, and as you
and
went
Clement
in...
And Clement Freud challenged.
Deviation, you can't be called Sir Noel and Lady Cole.
Clement very cleverly got you on a deviation there, and 17 seconds on moose, Clement, starting now.
The odd thing about moose is they have flattened antlers, not plain ones, as deer might have, but also raspberry, strawberry, and...
Derek, yes.
Hesitation,
Derek, yes. You have 8 seconds to tell us more about moose, starting now.
Raspberry moose, I must admit, is my absolute favourite, perhaps with a tinge of ice cream.
Well, Derek Nimmo, you were trailing, but you're now catching up on Clement Freud, our leader. Then comes Sandy Toksvig, and then Paul Merton, and our daughter. Clement Freud, your turn to begin. The subject, charlatans. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
A charlatan is a sort of mountebank, imposter, fraud, quack. Someone, in other words, who pretends to be something which he is not. To think in this audience of who might come under the term of charlatan, one would picture the lady in the fourth row with a green dress and the wig. Now, the reason why she isn't wearing her own hair is quite simply because of charlatanism, a manifestation...
Paul Merton challenged.
Deviation. She's not wearing it. She's wearing a wig because she's bald. Something to do with charlatanism.
Paul gets another point, and he has 30 seconds on charlatans, starting now.
The woman in the fourth row in the green dress happens to be my mother, and I know full well that her hair fell out in 1948 after Blackpool had been knocked out of the FA Cup. She was a very keen supporter of this particular seaside town, and...
Clement Freud challenged. Why?
Blackpool won the FA Cup.
They didn't. They won the cup in 1953.
That's right. So who...
What do you mean, that's right? You've no idea at all. Absolute rubbish. That's right, he says, sage.
Just ask my mother, she's there. Yeah,
that's right. She was deeply affected by the Blackpool, whether they won or lost.
Yeah. Can we put up the lady in the fourth row and ask her, is she his mother? Haven't said the things immediately.
So, Paul, you still keep the subject... And you have 17 seconds on charlatans, starting now.
There was a man once who posed as the King of Siam. What he did was he phoned up... Oh, I don't know. I didn't know.
Sandy Cox.
Were you prepared to get it back at all?
Yeah. So there we are. Sandy, you got in on the hesitation. 10 seconds, charlatans, starting now.
If you are...
And Clement Freud challenge.
That was a quite...
Definitely it was, yes, but she gets another point because it's the first time she's played the game. So...
Something horrible.
You didn't come in quick enough, so it's hesitation.
Golly, I just can't seem to get the hang of it.
There are 10 seconds on charlatans, starting now.
If you are a real charlatan, then the trick is to speak very slowly, but with very little substance.
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of theory. Yes.
Very slowly, with very little substance. Sorry, Sandy, it is a difficult game, but 4 seconds are left for Clement to tell us something about charlatans, starting now.
Pretending you know who won the FA Cup in 1948...
The whistle went, gained the extra point. He's now increased his lead at the end of that round, and it's very interesting, the other three are all equal in second place, 4 points behind. Sandy, it's your turn to begin. The subject is learning my lines. Will you tell us something about that, starting now?
As an aspiring actress, I was taught to learn my lines and not bump into the furniture. I was quite good at the latter, but not very adept at the former. When I received a part in the new Shakespeare company in Regent's Park, I was told that I was also required to understudy several principal roles. These included Beatrice in Much Ado About Nothing and Adriana in Comedy of Errors. As I was peculiarly unsuited to both these parts, it seemed to me a very difficult proposition that I should learn all the lines. Consequently, I decided not to bother to learn any of them at all. I received £6 a week for learning these lines, which, of course, I wasn't bothering to do as it was a very hot summer and I was quite busy out swimming. One day, they called an understudy rehearsal. This was going to be a problem as I had absolutely nothing to say at this particular perambulation of the plays required. I wish that someone would quite see...
I didn't want anyone to challenge you, Sandy, because you only had other 5 seconds. You'd have gone for the whole minute and got a bonus point. But Derek Nimmo came in and what of your... I know...
Coming to a damsel in distress.
Right. There are 6 seconds for you on learning my lines, Derek, starting now.
I have begrudged the enormous amount of my time that I've spent over the years learning my lines. And I could have...
Eric Nimmo, speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point. He's now in second place behind Clement Freud, and then comes Sandy Toksvig and Paul Merton, equal in third place. Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is glamour. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Glamour. To be charming, to be extraordinary, to be beautiful, one thing.
Sandy Toksvig.
Deviation, what does he know about it?
Well,
Sandy, you're getting the idea of the game. It's the fun we have as well as the correct scoring. But Derry gets the point for being interrupted, and he tells us a little bit more about glamour, if he can, with 55 seconds left, starting
in
now.
In 1959, I had the great good fortune to work in the play by Girardou entitled Duel of Angels, or in French, Pour le Cresse, with Vivian Leigh and Claire Bloom striding the stage together. And I have never seen two more beautiful, indeed glamorous, women on the stage at one time.
And Paul Merton challenged.
A repetition of stage.
That's right, you're on the stage, and again, striding the stage in 37 seconds. A left for you, Paul, to tell us something about glamour starting now.
Can there be a more glamorous figure in the world of show business than Mr. Nicholas Parsons? Everything...
Derek Nimmer's challenge.
Yes.
I don't know why the audience clapped, because you knew what the challenge was going to be as soon as it was Derek Nimmer, didn't you? So, Paul, you're interrupted with a rotten challenge. You keep the subject, you get another point, 32 seconds, glamour, starting now.
Not many people know that our chairman was once Miss Isle of Wight in 1948. And what a wonderful contest that must have been as these young girls stood next to the young...
Oh, Clement Freud sounds. Yes.
Repetition of young.
Young, there were too many young people around there. 20 seconds are left on glamour. Clement, starting now.
I think Derek Nimmo knows a great deal about glamour because sitting here listening to him talking over the years about China and Japan, about the Middle East and the far north, all things where he has travelled by airlines from different parts of the globe going to amazing territories.
Sandy talks big.
I don't know what he's talking about.
It is really very boring, isn't it?
Well, Derek's nodded off anyway.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
The glamour of travel.
I think deviation...
It gets people.
From, I've never heard of Clement be so boring. No, for once I thought he was back in the house. There are 2 seconds left for you, Sandy, on glamour, starting now.
There is very...
And Paul Merton challenge.
Hesitation.
Oh, shut up. Sandy's got another one. 1 second on glamour, starting now.
There's very little glamour to be had for people who...
So, at the end of that round, Sandy Toksvig, our first-time player of the game, with some help from the chairman, was speaking as the whistle went and gained an extra point for doing so. Clement Freud is still in the lead, but then comes Sandy Toksvig with Derek Nimmo in second place, and then Paul Merton 1 point behind them. It's all very close as Paul takes the next subject, which is fiddles. Will you tell us something about fiddles, Paul, starting now?
The fiddle has come back into vogue as a musical instrument in recent years, mainly, I think, through the efforts of Mr. Nigel Kennedy, who has helped, if we're led to believe, the publicity, popularise this instrument and bring it to a wider appreciative audience. His record of recording of the Four Seasons is currently riding very high in the hit parade, as Nicholas Parsons no doubt thinks of it still, and it is a wonderful piece of digital audio technology. The compact disc itself is an amazing adventure.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Sort of hesitation.
Yes,
a big
yes,
sort of swallow.
30 seconds for you, Derek, on fiddles, starting now.
I suppose when you say that somebody fiddles something, it's a kind of acceptable form of dishonesty. Commercial travellers, for instance, are always fiddlers of their expense accounts. And nobody looks too hard...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation, surely not all commercial travellers.
Sure, I'm sure they're not all...
They're a fine
maybe.
Body of men.
Yeah. And not only commercial travellers.
No, but I would agree with that. You could not state that all commercial travellers were. Some
we
maybe.
Don't persecute minorities on this show.
So, Paul, I agree with the challenge. You have another point, you have fiddles, and you have 16 seconds starting now.
One fiddle that I used to do, and I readily admit it now, was when I lived in a bedsit at the beginning of the last decade, there was an electricity meter in the corner of the room, and I would regularly put 10 pence coins in this particular box until I realised it wasn't connected to the meter supply at all. No.
Paul Merton kept going to the whistle, went, gained an extra point. He's equal with Derek Nimmo, 1 point behind our leader, Clement Freud, and 1 point behind those two is Sandy Toksvig, so it's very close. Clement Freud, it's your turn to begin. The subject is Covens. Will you tell us something about Covens in this game, starting now?
If you asked me to think of something appertaining to Covens, I would say not a subject about which I would like to speak for 60 seconds. It is, I think, a word that owes its origin to convent, coven being a number of witches dancing around as they might have done in a play by William Shakespeare written in the 16th century, whose name I know very well but don't want to tell you because you waste more time bumming around pretending you have forgotten. Many
Paul Merton challenged.
I have no idea what Clement's talking about. I've lost. What was this bit about the play?
Well, that is the play that actors don't like to mention because it's considered to be very superstitious, and there's always a catastrophe occurs in the next show they do.
Macbeth.
Yes, that's the one. What is your next show going to be after this one?
I'm recording another Just a Minute in about 5 minutes. I shall no doubt lose.
We'll look forward to that. So your challenge is what, actually? Deviation? You didn't know what he was talking about?
Yes.
No, I disagree with the challenge. So Clement keeps it 28 seconds on Covens, starting now.
The word ovens, preceded by the letter C, is actually Covens. And I'm awfully pleased with those cookery devices because you can put bread or meat.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Deviation. He's now talking about cookery devices rather than Covens.
Well, you can talk about cookery device as long as it doesn't deviate from Covens. I don't. Yeah, I agree. Cookery devices and Covens. No. It's
so well done, Nick.
Yes. Oh, I get all these challenges coming from all directions, and I have to interpret them and have to be fair at the same time, even when they're with Derek Nimmo with the things he says to me. Derek, I give you the judgment on that, and you have a point, and 19 seconds left on Covens starting
the
now.
The usual number of witches to a coven was 13, because it was a parody of the Lord's Supper. And the actual women in the coven had very frequently attached to them an extra nipple on which their familiar or cat used to drink. And that is how they actually...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of used. Used.
Yes, there were two useds. They used to drink and they were used to doing it. Well, Clement, you've got in on the last round with one second to go, and the subject is Covens, starting now.
Toil and trouble.
Well, as I said earlier on, there will be no more time after this round to play Just a Minute, so let me tell you what the final score was. Finishing in fourth place was our first-time guest, Sandy Toksvig, but she was only 1 point behind the man who's played the game a number of times, Paul Merton, and he was only 1 point behind the man who's played the game many, many times, Derek Nimmo, but just ahead of him was the one with the most points. So we say this week, here's our winner, Clement Freud. It only remains for me to say on behalf of all four of them, and of course the person who's been keeping the score, writing it down and blowing her whistle, and Ling, and of course the man who invented the game, which means we keep working, and that is Ian Messiter, and our director, who also helps us to keep working by employing us, and that is Edward Taylor, and myself, Nicholas Parsons. We hope you've enjoyed it and want to tune in again at the same time when we take to the air and play Just a Minute. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. My name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to introduce the four diverse and exciting personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. And we welcome back Wendy Richard, Peter Jones, Derek Nimmo, and Clement Freud. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits our producer's charming secretary, Anne Ling, with a stopwatch, a sheet of paper, and also a whistle which she blows when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I'm going to ask our four competitors of this game to speak, if they can, on the subject that I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. Clement Freud, would you begin the first round? The subject chosen is telepathy. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Telepathy is communication without words. The other day I was driving along to Suffolk, switched on my car radio, and heard, "Oh, give me a home where the buffalo roam, and the deer and the antelope play, where seldom is heard a discouraging word."
And Wendy Richard is challenged.
I knew you were going to say that. You're just using one of your ploys, your listing agent, aren't you, Clement?
Oh, I thought you were going to say, Wendy, that was your telepathy, because you knew he was going to say that. That's why the audience laughed, I think.
I know.
But is this going to be one of your difficult days?
It could well be.
It is, it could be. Clement, 42 seconds on telepathy, starting now.
And the sky is not cloudy or grey. Next, Jordan.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Long pause after that.
Hesitation.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Peter. Oh, yes. Yeah. You have a correct challenge. You get a point for that. And you have 36 seconds to talk on telepathy, starting now.
Well, it's marginally less reliable than British Telecom.
And your statement, you waited for the laugh, didn't you? And it didn't come. They're all members of British Telecom in the audience.
No, that's
the
trouble. Really?
Derek, you challenged.
I hesitate.
I agree with it. 30 seconds for you, Derek, on telepathy.
I've been married to my wife now for some 35 years, and we're in constant telepathic communication one with another. I rang her up the other day from Manchester and said, "What are you thinking about, darling?" She said, "Mushy peas." And I said, I was actually, at that very moment, in my head, was going through my mind exactly the same kind of vegetable.
What Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of mind.
Yes, you repeated the mind. You're trying to get away from the mushy peas, but you repeated the mind. 11 seconds are left for you, Clement, on telepathy, starting now.
I can look at my wife and know that she's going to say, "Surely you can wear that shirt for one more day." And it really isn't a question of telepathy. It is simply that we've been together now for...
Whoever is speaking as the whistle is blown gains an extra point. It was Clement Freud who started with the subject. And Wendy, would you take the next round? The subject is taking risks. I think anybody takes a risk coming on this show. But would you talk on the subject starting now?
Actually, you're right. We do take risks coming on this show because I seem to get bibbed constantly by the gentlemen on my left, all of them. And it is taking a risk every time I open my mouth, because I can see they're just hanging on their buttons waiting to put me out of action for a while, except they're not, because I just looked along and they're going to try and make me go the whole 60 seconds. Do you see what I have to put up with? It is extremely mean. And they are all taking another risk by being so unkind. But I shall undoubtedly carry on as best I can. Coming here in my taxi this evening, I thought I was taking a risk in getting through all the traffic, which is holding up all the streets around this West One area. As I live in West One, I'm actually not too far away from the Paris Theatre where we are sat at this very moment, but it seemed like an absolute nightmare getting here. I also take risks every day when I go to work. Have you seen some of the drivers down the A1? It's quite incredible. I don't actually know how to move a motor car about myself, as no doubt if you listen to this programme.
Well, Wendy, they were playing you at your own game. You tried to arouse them, and they did, but they were... And I let you keep going for 1 minute and 15 seconds because I
Thank
thought...
You.
I thought you deserved it, and the audience appreciated. So you not only get a point for speaking when the whistle went, but you also get a bonus point for not being interrupted. Derek Nimmo, it's your turn to begin. The subject is baudelarising. Will you talk about that subject in this game, if you can pronounce it, of course, starting now?
Well, Thomas Baudler is one of those people whose name has gone into the language for baudelarising, rather like Sigmund Freud has passed into the language with Freudian, and he, Dr. Spooner...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Repetition of Freud.
No, he did
Freudian.
Sigmund Freud.
And Freudian.
Freudian.
Ah, Freudian.
Yeah, I know, he was speaking into his
I thought you would have known the word.
Difficult to hear.
Just a Freudian slip.
No, 49 seconds are left with you, Derek, on baudelarising starting now.
Well, he was a man, of course, who cleaned up Shakespeare, the family edition, it was called. He took out all the rude bits, all things that one quite likes, really. For instance, bottom had to be called posterior in Midsummer Night's Dream, so the children, when reading, would not be offended by thinking it was a bum. They were able to go to sleep peacefully at night. I think it's a great pity he didn't do the,
Clement Freud, your challenge?
I hesitate.
Hesitation, correct. 21 seconds left on baudelarising starting now.
He was the Mrs. Whitehouse of his day, and it was extraordinarily stupid, I think, to look at the great verse and literature of this country and excise or eviscerate from it all those words and phrases which people were really rather fond of, which were descriptive and meaningful and incidentally filthy. And thanks.
So, Clement Freud kept going until the whistle went and has increased his lead at the end of that round. Peter Jones, your turn to begin. The subject is dives. Can you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Well, I haven't been to very many. I suppose this is really a dive because it's three floors down from street level, and there aren't any drinks or drugs or anything very reputable going on here.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Hesitation.
Right, 48 seconds are left on dives with you, Derek, starting now.
One of my favourite dives is the Go Down in Hong Kong. It's in Admiralty, and there it is run by the very nice fellow called Bill Nash, who dispenses champagne free of charge to all his chums. And I have a little brass plaque, and it says, Derek Nimmo sits here when in the colony, which I'm always rather touched by. Now, if you take a dive in boxing, that means that you're actually going to the ground and pretending that you have been hit harder.
Peter Jones has challenged.
A deviation.
Why?
Well, I don't believe he has this brass plate with Derek Nimmo's name on it, and he sits there when he's there, which can't be a large proportion of the time.
No.
And this man is too shrewd a businessman.
Our show does go out to Hong Kong, and I know it's very popular over there, if anybody listening this moment can tell us that, or write to us and tell us that Derek Nimmo does not have one, then he will be thoroughly penalised in the next series of Just a Minute.
They've only got 7 years.
I'm sure they can reply under 7 years. And Derek, we give you the benefit of the doubt and dive to continue. 24 seconds starting now.
I've never been very good at diving. Going to the top of the high diving board, and I've said diving twice, and it's not on the card.
Quite challenged.
Said it three times now.
And sometimes if you keep going with enough style and panache, they don't pick it up. But you gave yourself away, Derek, very sportingly. 17 seconds for Clement to tell us about dives, starting now.
The odd thing about dives in the United States of America is they all look as if prohibition was still on. They are seedy and dark and unpleasant, and people who serve there are hoodlum-like in their behaviour. Gin, whiskey, rum, brandy, and...
Clement Freud was again speaking as the whistle went. Gained an extra point, increased his lead. Derek Nimmo's in second place, and then comes Wendy, Richard and Peter Jones in that order. Clement, your turn to begin. The subject, Phineas Taylor Barnum, a wonderful character.
Barnum was a great circus man who, oddly enough, didn't start in trade on his own until he was 61 years old. The most famous, to me, and wonderful Barnum story is of the day that he was told of the death of the man who was fired from the circus on the sawdust under the tent where he operated. And he said, the death of this man is grave news. It will be hard to find a man of the same caliber.
And Wendy got the challenge in before you finished the story. What was it, Wendy?
I'm sorry for interrupting your story, but you said death twice.
I would have said it again.
You needed to for the story, but well done, Wendy. I waited till you finished the story. You got in on a correct repetition, and Phineas Taylor Barnum is the subject starting now.
There was a famous musical and a very successful one called Barnum, which was on at the Palladium, in which Michael Crawford starred. In fact, he did extremely well. This young man is a very talented actor and singer. I have seen him in Phantom of the Opera. I believe also he went...
And Peter Jones are challenged.
Well, she's doing a PR job for Michael Crawford. Yes, not Barnum.
That's right. She has deviated from the subject of Barnum and gone on to...
I was going to go back to Barnum. I hadn't got to New York yet.
You really established the PR job for Michael Crawford, who doesn't really need it anyway. 15 seconds with you, Peter, on Phineas Taylor Barnum, starting now.
He couldn't get people to leave the exhibition.
Oh, it is... What? Derry got it.
Hesitation.
Yes, hesitation. Right, Derry. 12 seconds on Phineas Taylor Barnum starting now.
Eventually, Phineas Taylor Barnum went into partnership with his great rival, Bailing, and it was they that invented the three-ring...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Some kind of hesitation.
What do you mean, some kind of hesitation?
Well, he was making a noise. There wasn't actual silence, but it was a hesitation in the flow of the anecdote, if I can put it as high as that.
But your challenge is that coherent speech was not coming out.
Yes, what a wonderful phrase. Yes, well done.
I actually did almost catch what he said.
You what?
See why they call me a straight man, can't you? There we are. Yes, I did just catch what he said, Peter. So it was
how
a good
long
try.
Have I got?
If Derek was generous, he would give it to you because you
he's
are
not.
Training a little. He's not generous, right? No. Derek, you have 5 seconds to continue on the subject, starting now.
He discovered the Swedish nightingale, Phineas Taylor Barnum, Jenny Lynn, and he had wonderful porcelain models made of the Covens Covens.
So Derek Nimmo has got points in that round. He's caught up with Clement Freud. They're both equal in the lead. Wendy Richard, your turn to begin. The subject is magpies, starting now.
I'm very superstitious about magpies, because as you know, if you see a magpie on its own, you have to say, good morning, Mr. Magpie, and how is Mrs. Magpie today? Otherwise, you're going to have bad luck. And the saying goes, one for sorrow, two for joy, three for a girl and four for a boy. Five for a letter and it's six for something else. I forget what it is now. But so on and so on.
It's an impossible game, isn't it? Clement Freud, you got in first?
Yes.
It would be you, wouldn't it?
Clement, you have 35 seconds on magpies, starting now.
A magpie is something on a target when you shoot, which is not a bull and isn't an outer either. I've never quite worked out how many points you get for it.
Peter Jones has challenged.
A repetition of isn't.
You are trying hard tonight, aren't you, Peter?
Isn't that right?
Yeah, it's absolutely right. We have usually sort of rather let these sort of little repetitions go, but on this occasion I have to be fair within the rules. It is a correct challenge.
Challenge.
You have 25 seconds on magpies starting now.
When my wife and I moved into our present home, there wasn't a magpie in sight, nowhere near, and now we're overrun with them and with squirrels. And these birds, who are related to crows and, I think, to blue jays, if I'm not mistaken, but they're very unpleasant and they steal things from bedrooms and they bully.
Derek got in there first, yes. 5 seconds on magpies, Derek, starting now.
Corruption, really, of Margaret and Piebald, a magpie being...
So, at the end of that round, Derek is now in the lead with just 1 point ahead of Clement Freud, and then come Wendy, Richard and Peter Jones, equal in third place. Derek, it's your turn to begin. Jokes. Can you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
I tend to get most of my jokes from the Times on a Thursday, from a column written by Sir Clement Freud. And he has jokes such as the dyslexic atheist who tried all his life to prove that a dog doesn't exist. And I always thought that was a very good joke. And also the one about the Scotsman who took part in a pornographic movie and was so mean he always ran it backwards to see the prostitute giving him the money. And I think those are the other people who do have particularly good jokes are comedians like Terry Scott. Now, he has a different kind of jocular manner. And a joke of his, which I would like to give to you, is a man going into a kitchen, finding it absolutely filthy, and he sees the chef going round the tart with his false teeth. Now, that's absolutely disgusting. You ought to have a tool for that. He said, yes, but I save that for the donuts. And those are jokes.
I think you were saved by the whistle, Derek. You have a point, anyway, for speaking when the whistle went and have increased your lead at the end of the round. And Peter Jones, your turn to begin. Madras, that is the subject. Can you tell us something about it in this game, starting now?
I think of curry, and I think of that material they weave there from cotton, because it's a very hot part of the world. And this material...
Derek, no more challenge.
Oh.
This material, yes. 40 seconds are left. Madras.
The very first settlement in India by the British East Indian Company was in Madras in 1640. It was called Fort St. George at the time. It is the centre of the Tamil population of the great subcontinent. And Peter's quite right. They do weave the most excellent cotton and thread there. And that's why people from Madras have been sent to East Africa, Malaysia and so on, also to take part in the same trade. Madras, I find very hot. I like the curries enormously. Probably better than the...
And Clement got in.
Yes, it is.
There was an there. Yes, Clement, you have another point and 12 seconds to tell us something about Madras, starting now.
Madras is a contraction of Shrove Tuesday or Mardi Gras, as it is called in French. It's also a province of...
Peter Eric Nimmo challenged.
Deviation. Total rubbish. The contraction of Shrove Tuesday. What are you talking about?
Madras is not a corruption of Mardi Gras. And anyway, maybe in your language or maybe in the column you write for the Times...
You know so much, Nick.
No, I don't. But I do have to make decisions and be seen to be fair to everybody taking part in the show. And I think on this occasion I would agree with Derek's challenge and say he has 5 seconds to take over back Madras, starting now.
There was a young lady from Madras who set herself down on her bottom. Dr. Bowdler said that's how it should be pronounced because he didn't like the new person to go out.
You've increased your lead at the end of that round. And Clement Freud, your turn to begin. The subject is puns. 60 seconds as usual, starting now. Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I think so. Once, Clement Freud was absolutely speechless. It's never been known to happen in just a minute before. 59 seconds for you on puns, Peter, starting now.
Puns is the initials...
Clement as Freud has got it back. Puns is with you, Clement. 56 seconds starting now. Peter Jones. You challenged again. Another hesitation. Well done. You've got the subject back again. 55 seconds on puns starting now.
Philip Unwin and Nigel Street. Two very nice chaps who preceded Gilbert and George in the artistic world. And they were very similar. They walked about arm together and they lived in Putney.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Lived in Putney.
Putney,
no,
yes.
Lived in Putney.
Yes, well, that's what you should have said.
What?
That's what you should have said.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I didn't.
You erred before you got to Putney. Oh, I know I other people have done the same thing as they've approached Putney. In this game, you can't say it. 39 seconds for you, Derek, to tell us something about puns
the
starting now.
The leader of the opposition, Mr. Neil Kinnock, is much given to puns. They're not frightfully funny, but he seems terribly keen on them. For instance, he said the other day, he said, Michael Heseltine...
Clement Freud.
Two sids.
Clement has a correct challenge. 28 seconds for you, puns, Clement, starting now.
On the whole, people get extraordinarily tired of people who make puns about their name, and I've said people twice.
And Peter Jones picked it up first.
Well,
right,
he did, yes. Yes.
Look, well done, Peter. 23 seconds.
That's
for
not
you.
Too short a word, I mean, is it? People.
No.
People,
no. The bitterness is showing, Peter. Oh, dear me, they'll try any ploy, won't they, to get one over on me. 23 seconds, puns with you, Peter, starting now.
They lived in this South London terrace house next to a poet, and they used to pose for photographs a lot. And there are one or two still available in sepia, I've seen.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
I really can't see what this has got to do with puns. He's peasing...
Philip Unwin and Norman Street. These two young men that I... Well, I don't
care. I don't want to know about
well.
You and these two young men.
I think Peter's demonstrated he doesn't know what it's got to do with puns either.
P-U-N-S.
There are 12 seconds for you, Derek, on puns starting
Michael
now.
Heseltine was unstable... And the only thing you can say about Douglas Hurd is he is stable. And then as far as Mr. the Prime Minister is...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Hesitation.
It's hesitation and repetition. And for those abroad who don't know, he was trying to impersonate the Leader of the Opposition, Neil Kinnock. Not very successfully, I would add, but... 3 seconds for you on puns, starting now.
I'm pretty sick of Freud, eggs and bacon. Also...
Clement Freud, then speaking, as the whistle went, got that extra point, has moved forward. He's still in second place, two behind Derek Nimmo. Wendy, your turn to begin, and the subject is stamps. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
When I was a child, I used to collect stamps, and some stamps have the most beautiful illustrations on them. In fact, I have seen stamps with pictures of cockatiels that look just like little Henry on them. I still collect stamps now, because if you tear off any used stamp, it doesn't matter.
Peter Jones's challenge.
Well, she did say collect twice.
Did I?
Yes, you did. Mm. Why do you say it in that sort of way, as if you weren't confident of your challenge?
Well, you know me, I'm so insecure. And I think it's terribly embarrassing. You should have brought that up, Nicholas, really. Okay. I think you could have just glossed over that, for goodness sake. I don't want to parade all my insecurity all over the world.
You've made a good living out of it, Peter. 43 seconds on stamps with you, Peter, starting now.
Wonderful things to collect because they don't take up much room and you can actually fill a whole house with stamps and still have a lot of space left. Now, if you, on the other hand, try to assemble a lot of traction engines or farm utensils, then soon there isn't any space left.
Wendy has challenged.
I think we have space twice,
no,
do we not?
Room and space.
No, you could have had him for deviation because he's now got on to other kind of collecting other than stamps, but I'm afraid you didn't. 24 seconds left. Peter, still with you. Stamps starting now.
I know a man who once advertised the picture of the Queen, which he said was an engraving, and asked people to send a pound. And in return, he would post them this. And he posted them a stamp. And made
and
quite a lot of money.
Zero challenge.
Hesitation. You post them a stamp.
Yes, you know why I hesitate, because you repeated posted.
I know, I had
why.
To, otherwise it wouldn't have made
going,
sense at all.
Peter.
I was host by my own petard.
Yeah. 9 seconds on stamps. Did you bring your private laughers in? Because there's some people laughing at only your jokes, you know.
Oh, really? Well, I don't
know. 9 seconds, Derek. Stamps, starting now.
The British Guiana 1 cent magenta is the most expensive stamp ever sold. It, with Stanley Gibbons...
Wendy Richardson.
You had a hesitation
yes,
there,
I would agree,
we?
Wendy. That was a hesitation.
How can it be expensive if it's only 1 cent?
Right, 4 seconds on stamps with you, Wendy, starting now.
Collecting stamps is a good way of learning geography. Not only do you have the attractive design...
So, Wendy Richards being the whistle, Wendy gained that extra point and she's leapt forward and she's still in fourth place. Not far behind Peter Jones. and little way behind Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo in that order. And Derek, your turn to begin. And let me tell you, this is the last round, and it's neck and neck between you and Clement. Derek, the subject is presence of mind. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
If you play just a minute, you have to have great presence of mind and able to talk about things like telepathy, taking risks, paralyzing, dives, Finland, Taylor, Barnum, magpies, jokes, Madras, also puns, stamps, and in particular, presence of mind. And that's what one tries to have as one steals oneself coming
and
into this.
Wendy, Richard challenged you.
We've got about half a dozen ones, have we not?
No, we've had more than one ones. Yes, yes, indeed. Well done, Wendy. 42 seconds. You've overtaken Peter. And there are presence of minds with you starting now.
Presence of mind means knowing how to cope with a difficult situation. Some time ago, I was filming with the London Fire Brigade. The chaps of that wonderful order of gentlemen, I have a great...
Clement Freud challenge.
You?
Me.
I was going to say something fascinating then.
Clement, why did you challenge?
I'm sorry, I buzzed. There are women in the fire service as well.
Yes, I do.
Yes, but the story I was coming up with, there weren't any there. It was just me and all these handsome young men.
I would agree with Clement's challenge, so 28
You'll
seconds for you,
know.
Clement.
Oh.
Well, even if Clement wins this round, I don't think he'll win the show, so I'm sure the audience reaction means they'd like to hear from Wendy on the rest of this round for the rest of the show, if she can make it, because you have 28 seconds. You might still be challenged, of course, on presence of mind, Wendy, starting now.
He's taking my buzzer.
Clement challenged again.
Hesitation.
But as you press Wendy's buzzer, it meant she was buzzing herself for hesitation. So, Wendy, that was a correct challenge. You have another point. And you have 26 seconds on presence of mind, starting now.
Who, me?
Yes.
Right. Anyway, we're at this fire station.
And challenge, you've been challenged again. What was it? No. Derek, yes.
Fire station, repetition of fire.
No, that's wrong. Derek. Wendy. Incorrect challenge. Now, the presence of mind is still with you. Try to control yourself and give us presence of mind and go on talking for 21 seconds on the subject of presence of mind, starting now.
And the alarm bell went off and we all had to rush onto this fire engine and I couldn't get on it because I had these yellow waders on and this young person from the fire brigade didn't know how to get me on this fire engine and all of a sudden he just went wallop straight up my bottom, as Mr. Boulderizing would say, and I fell flat on my face on the vehicle.
Well, in spite of repeating fire engine and fire brigade and hesitating and deviating from the subject of presence of mind, Wendy kept going.
No, but he was showing presence of mind.
You were showing presence of mind.
I would like to know, was the film released?
Anyway, the audience enjoyed it, which is all that matters in just a minute. And Wendy, they got an extra point, but speaking of, as a whistle went, and you have, at the end of the show now, leapt forward to join Peter Jones in third place, a little way behind Clement Freud, but we do have to declare a winner. So we say this week it is Derek Nimmo. It only remains for me to say thank you very much to our four excellent panellists for the contributions they make and the fun they provide, and also to thank Anne Ling, who's kept the score so magnificently without any deviations, hesitations or repetitions, and also, of course, the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, who can't be with us, and our producer, Edward Taylor, who, thank goodness, is with us. From all of us here, goodbye. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to introduce to you the four different and exciting personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud, Paul Merton, and Jimmy Mulville. Will you please welcome all four of them? Our producer, talented secretary Anne Ling, sits beside me. She has a stopwatch in one hand, which I read for the time. She has a pen to put down the scores. She has a whistle which she blows when 60 seconds are up. And I have the subjects in front of me, and I'm going to ask all four at different times, of course, to speak, if they can, on the subject I give them. And they will try and do that, as always, without hesitation or repetition or deviating from the subject. Clement Freud, will you take the first round? The subject is bags. You can take it in so many different ways. Will you talk on the subject starting now?
The way I would like to take bags is an item of luggage. Now, the odd thing about bags when I first was able to afford one was I went to Switzerland, and when I came out of the train, the porter put a chalk mark onto my bags denoting that I was a light tipper. And as a result, when I got to the hotel, I got the most appalling service. The people in this hostelry investigated my bags and found the hieroglyphics, which were two strokes and a circle, to denote that I would leave very little money in return for services rendered. I think this is an absolutely revolting, disgusting, unpleasant and nasty thing to do, as you would expect the Swiss to behave normally, especially if you...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He's no longer talking about bags. He's talking about his inherent meanness.
I don't know if it's all about that, but I think he had got off the subject of bags onto the subject of the Swiss. So we give you a point for a correct challenge of deviation, and say there are 13 seconds left, and you take over the subject of bags, Derek, starting now.
Bags, in the sense of women, it can be applied to the ladies who were actually following the troops in days of old. They came along with the baggage, and that is why they were so named bags. Now, there is a public...
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, and it was on this occasion Derek Nimmo and Paul Merton. Will you take the next round? Walking the dog. Will you tell us something about that in this game starting now?
I haven't got a dog, but I've often dreamed of having one, and if I did own such an animal, what I would do would first of all purchase a lead, because I think that's the best way to walk a dog. It's no good expecting it just to run off and then it come back at some time or other, because it won't. It'll get a job somewhere, it'll perhaps drive in HGV lorries. Oh, I thought somebody challenged me. No, he didn't. or run its own business delivering parcels in the West End area. These are the sort of things that dogs get up to. So that's why owners make sure that they control their dogs by a very long piece of rope or twine.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Station of a rope.
Of a rope, because he was trying not to say lead again. Derek, you've got him with another point for a correct challenge. And 28 seconds, walking the dog, starting now.
Walking the dog is something which used to be done by the governor's wife in Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia in the last century. And in consequence of that, the cricket pitch around which you used
and
to walk
Clement
to
this day... challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
It wasn't called Malaysia in the last century.
It's now.
No, it became Malaysia after independence. It was Malay Straits before then. And Clement, as we go out to every country, including the Malaysia, I'm very glad you drew their attention to that. Mm-hmm. And you get a point for doing so.
What was it called then, Nick?
Yes. The Malay Straits.
No, just called Malaya. Or the Straits
No, before
settlements.
That it was called the Malay Straits.
Straits Settlers. No, it wasn't never called Malaysia. It was called Straits Settlers.
I have got postage stamps at home in my album with Malay Straits written across them. Who did put a challenge for?
The subject's walking the dog.
A bonus point to Paul Merton. The subject's with Clement Freud. 17 seconds left, Clement. Walking the dog, starting now.
It is, of course, essential to have a dog in the first place, but when you have such an animal, put your left foot in front of your right and then repeat the process and see whether the canine friend will not follow or go on ahead. This is called walking the dog, a job often done by butlers.
On that occasion, Clement Freud was speaking as the whistle went, gained that all-important extra point. He's now in second place, Derek Nimmo's in the lead, and Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, 1066, a date that everybody in our country knows about, one of the first things I learned at school. Will you tell us something that you learned about it, starting now?
The first memorable thing that happened that year was the death of Edward the Confessor, who named as his successor King Harold, as he subsequently became after the coronation. But then there immediately arose a rebellion in the north of England led by Tostig, and he managed to get the ruler of Norway to join him in this revolt. And the troops marched north, north.
What's your ball? Yes.
Lapsing into Middle English.
That's right, yes. Yes, they marched them. I thought you were going to have him for showing off, actually, but...
I was a bit waiting to hear where Derek played an important part in this.
Yes. Yes, well, it did seem to come from memory, didn't it? Paul, you have 34 seconds to tell us something about 1066, starting now.
1066 are the four digits that formed the last...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
I really hesitated.
No, I don't think it is.
Do you think so? Oh, I thought so, yes. I mean,
definitely not.
No, this is the way the sound carries.
Nobody in the audience.
Oh, right.
Nobody
right.
in the audience.
Oh, well, I'm quite prepared to admit that you can't hear.
Yeah. They don't want to hear any more from you on 1066. They were bored to death in marching up to the north. And... 30 seconds for you, Paul, with another point. 1066, starting now.
1066... Fulton.
Jimmy Mulville challenge.
That was hesitation.
That was hesitation, Jimmy. Yes, well done. Nice to hear from you.
Well, I couldn't get a word in edgeways, you see.
I know. You haven't played quite as much, but you've got in. Lovely to hear from you again. 27 seconds, 1066, starting now.
It is a year in which the Normans came over to this country and brought with them all manner of different forms of language. Before that, we had to use Anglo-Saxon and the bits that the Romans didn't want. Then we were forced to use words like
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Forced.
What was the other force he had?
They were forced, isn't they? And they were forced to use bits of the Romans.
I know he said it. But
so make one and one makes two, Nick, you see.
I know. But you see, also occasionally, I'm generous because when somebody has only played the game for about the third or fourth time, you've only played it in the last series once,
I
actually pretend I didn't hear. And
say, right. Oh, yeah, good. Yeah. Yes.
All right. Okay.
I thought it was a battery running down.
Yeah. No, I don't have a pacemaker like you, Jerry. 10 seconds with you, Jimmy, still on 1066.
I was once at university with a man whose great claim to fame was that his family came over with the Normans.
Clement Freud challenged.
Two Normans.
Yes, I'm afraid I can't.
In the last go, wasn't it?
Yes, I know.
Oh, I see. It's a continuous item.
It's in this round, though. It was in the last time you were...
I stayed at home and watched television. Yeah.
Probably see yourself. You're on so frequently.
There's a bitter man.
I've said before, Derek, it takes one to recognise one.
Now, girls, please.
There are 4 seconds for Clement to keep going on 1066, starting now.
1066 was a very poor year for comedians. They were virtually...
Well, at the end of that round, Clement Freud is in the lead. He's only 1 point ahead of Paul Merton and Derek Nimmo equal, and then one behind them comes Jimmy Mulville, who will be in the next round. Jimmy, alternative comedy. You started there, but you've moved into the mainstream, as it's called. But can you talk on the subject starting now?
I doubt it, but let me try. I think that people get mixed up when they think of alternative comedy. You see, it didn't actually begin in the late 70s, early 80s. It does, in fact, go back to the court of Henry VIII, who was fed up listening to mother-in-law jokes, having had 6 wives. And he called his fool to him and said, "Look, I am really..."
And Derek Nimmo got in first.
It was a very nasty F, which he changed to something else.
So what were you challenging for?
Hesitation.
Hesitation, yeah. Right. 38 seconds on alternative comedy, Derek, starting now.
Well, of course, it really goes back to King Harold, who was greatly influenced by Normandy when they shot him in the eye, and he had to go for alternative comedy to Westminster Abbey.
Jimmy Mulville challenge.
He's talking gibberish.
I don't think that is alternative comedy.
No, alternative comedy is gibberish.
No.
There's a bitter man.
There's a bitter man.
You mean there was nothing comic about being shot in the eye, so I agree with your challenge. You have 27 seconds on alternative comedy starting now.
The definition of an alternative comedian is someone who has made his name sniping at the establishment and makes his fortune doing adverts for it. This little phenomenon of comedy goes back to about 1980 in this area of London, Soho. People like Rick Mayall, Alexis Sale, Peter Robinson, Robbie Coltrane...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation, I've never heard of Peter Robinson.
He didn't do very well. He was a bit of a one-night stand man. He then changed his name to... Alistair Burnett.
D.H. Evans.
D.H. Evans, that was it.
D.H. Evans, yes. Right, I agree. He very cleverly, he almost bluffed us out, but...
He was actually in a show called Cliffhanger, Peter Robinson. He changed his name to Peter something else.
Yes, but he wasn't very alternative.
How am I doing?
I'm swayed by your powerful argument.
That's right, yes. But Paul Merton, who's made a great success in alternative comedy, will now talk on the subject with 7 seconds to go, starting now.
Such a success have I made in this chosen career, I find myself sharing a stage with Nicholas Parsons.
You have gained an extra point then for seeking the whistle wind, and you are now in the lead at the end of that round. And Clement Freud, your turn to begin again. The subject is burglars. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
Burglars are people who take things which do not belong to them, rather like comedians who steal jokes from Arthur Haynes or Nicholas Parsons, who would not be good people from whom, to whom, of whom.
You challenge, Paul.
Repetition of whom?
Whom, yes. That's right, yes, because he didn't quite deviate, but nearly. 47 seconds, burglars, Paul, starting now.
About a year ago, I had a burglar. I was lucky, I disturbed him. I said, there is no God. But he was a kind of individual who likes to rob people of their possessions when they're not in, hopefully. And I disturbed him outside.
And Derek Nimmo challenged.
Too disturbed.
Yes, he was too disturbed, I'm sorry. Yeah. 30 seconds are left for burglars. It's you, Derek, starting now.
The last time I had an intrusion by a burglar, I just had a heart bypass, and I was lying on my bed, and a cello smashed the door down, came in, and took all kinds of possessions from me, which I greatly valued, and I miss sincerely. I then have put in all manner of devices to prevent them. I have pads and locks, and alarms to go directly to the police station. And I've joined Neighbourhood Watch, and I ask you all to join that particular organisation because it's very worthwhile.
Such a pathetic story, nobody dared to challenge him. But well done, Derek. You kept going to the whistle end. You gain an extra point for doing so, and you'll be in the lead now with Paul Merton equal, and then comes Clement, and then Jimmy Melville. And Paul, your turn to begin. The bottom line. Take it any way you wish, but talk on the subject, starting now.
The bottom line can often be referred to as well as VPL, which is visible panty line, which the women in the audience no doubt will know what I'm talking about. It's a rather unsightly ridge you sometimes have appear at the back.
Derek Nimmo, son.
Two sometimes.
Yeah, two sometimes. Tough challenge, but it's correct.
Not particularly tough, it's just perfectly obvious. He says sometimes twice and you press the button. I don't think there is...
But sometimes I've noticed you're all very sporting and let someone get underway so that, you know, you can have a bit of a flair and flourish from them before you challenge with a tough one. 47 seconds are left on the bottom line with you, Derek, starting now.
I suppose you can call the bottom line on a boat the plimsoll line. He was an MP, a gentleman of that name, for Derby, and he brought in an act for the shipping bill of 1887 because... vessels were being tremendously overloaded, and even more importantly,
Paul Merton challenged.
With deviation, we're talking about the shipping bill of the last century now.
And the bottom line, to bring in the Plimsoll line.
No.
The pencil line isn't the bottom line.
No, the brimsy.
He didn't actually bottom line to which they're allowed to be loaded.
No, he didn't. I must listen to it. Paul actually didn't challenge for that. And just to show you how fair I am after the things Derek says to me, he didn't challenge for the fact that it isn't the bottom line, which I would have agreed with if you challenged for that.
That was my second point.
Yeah. And he was still, to my mind, talking about the plimsoll line, which, in his mind, he'd established was the bottom line. So, Derek, I'm being generous and saying you have the benefit of the doubt. Another point to you, 31 seconds, the bottom line, starting
if
now.
If you're preparing a set of accounts, you put at the top your income, which might come from a variety of sources, and you add all that together and subtract from it the expenses that you have incurred. And at the bottom, beneath, you will have what they call the bottom line, which means you've either made profit or indeed, perhaps, if you've been unlucky enough and injudicious enough, a loss.
And you've got to, Clement.
Repetition of enough.
That's right, yes, I nearly said it, I'm sorry.
Not an important word, but he said it twice.
Yes. And he said it very deliberately, too. So, Clement, 5 seconds for you on the bottom line, starting now.
When I went to have a skin graft, they looked at my posterior and said, surely that is...
And the intriguing thing about Just a Minute is that we will never know about Clement Freud's posterior and what happened when they looked at it after they'd seen the skin. Because the whistle went, he gained an extra point for speaking at that moment. He's equal with Paul Merton in second place behind Derek Nimmo, and then is Jimmy Mulville. And Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is stoppers. Will you tell us something about stoppers in Just a Minute, starting now?
Best kind of stoppers for a bottle of wine probably are made from cork. In fact, actually, they're always made from cork, which can...
And Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of cork, I'm
absolutely
afraid.
Yes, and
a little word, but
well,
I mean...
Yeah. 52 seconds are left for stoppers with you, Paul, starting now.
Stoppers is a piece of football jargon. It's a phrase that managers talk to describe about old-fashioned centre-halves, and there's a sentence and a half indeed. Mm. It is a...
No. Jimmy Mulville, you've got in on that one.
He sort of stopped himself, didn't he?
He stopped himself. Hesitation and deviation. But you've got in, and you have a correct challenge. 41 seconds to tell us something about stoppers, starting now.
The best stopper I ever saw was a man called Morris Setters, who wasn't an alternative comedian, but in fact, the way he played football, he did used to get a few laughs. His method of playing that particular game was to stop anybody...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of playing...
No, he didn't say playing before.
No. I said forcing twice, but I didn't say playing.
No. 27 seconds for you, Jimmy, on stopper, starting now.
And this was a very, very...
Clement challenge.
Repetition.
Of what?
West Bromwich Albion. Very, very...
I might disagree, but he did say very, very, yes. I agree with that one. 22 seconds on stoppers, starting now.
There was an awfully jolly sort of sweetmeat called a gobstopper, which you put in your mouth, which made it absolutely impossible for you to speak, which would have been enormously helpful for anyone playing Just a Minute or other similar pursuits. Stoppers in football are, as has very rightly been said, people who are the opposite of strikers in that they prevent...
Clement Freud is now equal on the lead with Derek Nimmo, and then comes Paul Merton, and then Jimmy Mulville. And Jimmy, your turn to begin. The subject, throwing a party.
Throwing a party is a subject very close to my heart. In the old days, when I was in my 20s, it was no sweat at all. Just a bottle of wine, a lump of cheese, some friends, a room, and there you had it, a very good party. Today, it seems that we need some kind of a reason to throw a party, a theme. And it is these sort of parties against which I rail. Today, we have 20s parties where people come dressed as the Depression, 30s parties, 40s parties.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Hello, Derek, come in.
Sorry. Yes, I can't think of a challenge at the moment.
I wish I could help.
But
we'll just have a game of cards, and you think of one, and then will you...
22 seconds for you, Jimmy, to carry on with throwing a party.
I've been to a 60s party, a 70s party, an 80s party, and last week I went to a 90s party. I've been to a party...
Derek, never challenge.
The traditional went. He went to a 60s
party. Yeah, he went to... You went too often. You also repeated 80s, 90s and 60s. Anyway, there are 12 seconds for you, Derek, on throwing a party starting now.
Last night, a very dear friend of mine called Derek Pico, who runs the Sheraton Park Tower Hotel, threw the most wonderful party. We had fireworks, and it was for the Savoy gastronomes.
Jimmy Melville Chum.
Not hesitation, and I thought you weren't allowed to advertise on the BBC.
Well, you're not officially allowed to advertise, but...
Well, he was plugging one of his mate's gas, wasn't he? Sheraton Park Hotel. But pretty ropey as well, actually.
But the rules I have to try and stick to...
Freud is going for lunch there this week.
If he doesn't hesitate, deviate, or repeat himself...
I thought there was a slight hesitation as well, actually.
But it's a bit late now to come in with that one, Jim. Sorry.
Hesitation.
Yes, well...
He nicked my hesitation.
Yes, that's right. But, Derek, you still have 2 seconds to tell us something about throwing a party starting now.
The best part I ever went to was on VJ.
Clement Freud Challenge.
He's already talked about the best one.
The best party. Yes, the best party once before. That's right, yes. So... That's what happens if you get interrupted, isn't it? Bad. 1 second, Clement. Well done. Throwing a party starting now.
RSVP.
Clement's now in the lead at the end of that round, but only single points separate them all in descending order. And it's also your turn to begin, Clement. The subject is Marconi. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Marconi was one of the few Italians who did not have a pasta named after him, which is more than you can say about macaroni, probably a distant relative. And the type of fettuccine to which he gave his name was the hull of spaghetti.
A poor Merton challenge.
Deviation. We're talking about pasta now.
We're on to pasta and fettuccinis and all of this. We're not off Marconi.
What do you do with Marconi?
No. I think you were definitely off the subject, deviating, and Paul Merton got in with a correct challenge. 44 seconds, Marconi, Paul, starting now.
One of my old school chums who I remember from many years ago was Eric Marconi. What a wonderful boy he was. He was so clever at all the different lessons in the school. He was good at mathematics, history, English, woodwork, technical drawing, geography, French, Spanish, German, Russian, Latin, chemistry, biology, physics, and he was quite good at sports as well. Yeah. Football, cricket.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of good.
Oh, yes. You didn't deserve that after reeling off all those subjects. Well done, Paul. Almost as own a bovinus for that. But Clement got in with the correct challenge. 15 seconds on Marconi, starting now.
He was into communications quite heavily, and Jack the Ripper, or one of those fairly famous criminals...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. It was, in fact, Dr. Crippen.
Dr. Crippen.
Who was...
What are you talking about?
Well, what are you... We don't know what you're talking about. What's the connection between Marconi and Jack the Ripper?
Just wait for it.
I'm prepared to wait for it.
All right, you're prepared to wait for it. Let's see what happens then. 8 seconds on Marconi... Clement, starting now.
Might have been caught as quickly as Dr. Crippen. Have the same scientific...
Sorry, Paul has challenged you again.
I waited, and I still think it's deviation.
You think that he would not have been caught as quick as Dr. Crippen?
No, because Crippen was caught because he was on a transatlantic liner, and they radioed ahead and said, Dr. Crippen's on this boat.
Jack the Ripper was never caught.
Paul, you have a correct challenge, and you want him with 1 second to go on Marconi, starting now.
Marconi!
Clement Freud and Paul Merton are now equal in the lead. Just two ahead of Derek Nimmo, and one behind that is Jimmy Melville, and we move into the last round, so anybody can win. The subject is manners, and it's Paul Merton's turn to begin. Paul, will you start talking now?
Some people say that manners aren't what they used to be. They look back to some golden age where men were chivalrous and society...
Derek Nimmo, challenge. I think that was hesitation, yes, his manners... Derek got in on 52 seconds on the subject, starting now.
Manners is the family name of the Duke of Rutland. He is, in fact, married to a very lovely woman who is the daughter of Margaret Argyle and Charles Sweeney, she being the Duchess thereof. And
Marvel challenge.
He sort of hesitated, didn't he? On one of the Duchesses.
Yes, he was trying to make up some more relations. I don't know this. And so, Jimmy, I agree with your challenge, and you have 36 seconds to tell us something about manners starting now.
I was always told when I was a boy to stand up for anybody who was on the bus. And I was, when I was a child, forced by my mother to give up my seat whenever I saw an old-age pensioner or a pregnant lady. Or in...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Deviation has got nothing to do with manners. This is to do with maternal... pressures.
Hmm. You obviously want to win the game.
No,
because I would disagree.
No,
how I learnt my manners. How did you learn your manners? Oh,
no,
sorry.
No, that was.
It's not manners.
It is. That is good manners, standing up for old age pensioners.
Not
and
being made
always,
to I've by
always
your
done
mother.
It, I've always done it for you, Clement, so...
Yes, and... Right, and I stand up for Jimmy Melville on this occasion, metaphorically speaking, of course, and it also makes the score very equal as we carry on with 22 seconds with you, Jimmy. Manners starting now.
Of course, manners oil the machinery of society. Without manners, we would not exist. If I thought I could take it upon myself...
Paul Merton, challenge.
Deviation. I think, we could exist without manners.
I agree with your challenge, and you have 16 seconds to tell us something about the subject starting now.
There are certain things that are regarded as good manners. For example, standing up for people who may be less fortunate than yourselves or on public transport.
Jimmy Melville, challenge.
I don't think it's a socio-economic thing, is it? Less fortunate than ourselves. I mean, what's he getting on about?
Well, if
you don't have to have a means test before you give up your seat, do you? Can I have evidence of you?
Jimmy, I see your interpretation to do with money and means, and we are in a market-orientated society, so I give you a bonus point for an interesting challenge, but after all, people are less fortunate could be crippled or something like that, so
he's
Paul would stand
manners,
up for
he's got lovely manners, hasn't he,
Nicholas?
What's that? I said you've got lovely manners.
Yes, and so Paul has
totally
a... I disagree with your challenge. Paul still keeps the subject. 6 seconds left. Starting now.
My parents drummed into me from a very early age the importance of good manners.
So as I said a little while ago, this was to be the last round, so let me give you the final score. What I love is the contribution they all make. The score, to my mind, is secondary. But Derek Nimmo, who often wins, came in fourth place, but only 1 point behind Jimmy Melville and Clement Freud, equal in second place, and they were only 3 points behind the one who has most points this week. So we judge him to be the winner, Paul Merton. It only remains for me to say, on behalf of all four of them who've entertained the audience so well, and we hope the audience thank you very much, on behalf of Anne Lynn, who's kept the score and kept the stopwatch moving, and, of course, the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, our producer, Edward Taylor, and from me, Nicholas Parsons, we hope you've enjoyed it and will want to tune in again same time when we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to introduce the four talented performers who this week are going to play Just a Minute. And we welcome back four regular players of the game, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Wendy Richard, and Clement Freud. Will you please welcome all four of them? Mm. Anne Ling is sitting beside me. She has a stopwatch in one hand, a whistle in the other, and a piece of paper on which to keep the score. And as usual, I'm going to ask our four competitors, our four panellists, to compete against each other and try and speak on the subject that I give them. And they will try and do that, as always, without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. This week, we're going to begin the show with Peter Jones. Peter, the subject, a good part to play. I'm sure you've had many in your time, but will you talk on that subject in just a minute, starting now?
I'm not sure whether it means a good part to play on the stage in a theatre or whether on the great theatre of life.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Unfortunately, there was a rather premature
Yes, a premature
It wasn't due for another 9 seconds, at least.
That we interpret as hesitation, and as it was a correct challenge, you get a point for that, Derek, and you take over the subject, and there are 53 seconds left, a good part to play, starting now.
Apparently, Nicholas Parsons had a very good part to play in the Stephen Sondheim musical out of the...
Peter Jones challenged.
I thought there was going to be a hesitation.
No, there wasn't.
And I was anticipating it.
For once, actually, he was going to pay me a compliment, I think.
That's why I was... hesitation.
So I disagree with your challenge, Peter, but well tried. So Derek keeps the subject and a point for an incorrect challenge. 49 seconds, a good part to play, starting now.
All sorts of people are trying to get jobs in acting and getting good parts to play these days. Roddy Llewellyn apparently auditioned recently. In fact, Nicholas Parsons in...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of Nicholas Parsons.
I know. Some people say you can have too much of Nicholas Parsons. In just a minute, you can, because you cannot repeat. And 32 seconds are left for you, Clement, to take over the subject. A good part to play, starting now.
A very good part to play would be that of Anne Ling in just a minute, because she has a stopwatch in one hand and a whistle in the other, and you wonder what she keeps the score with. But there are many other important parts that you could play. I think, for instance, Bottom in Midsummer Night's Dream or Wendy Richards in EastEnders would be...
Wendy Richard challenge.
My name wrong. Can I challenge him for that?
No, but you don't play Wendy Richard in EastEnders. You play
no,
a character,
don't
you?
That's right, you're wrong.
Yeah, yes, that's it. So tell us the character you play, Wendy.
Pauline.
She's Pauline in EastEnders, not Wendy Richard in EastEnders.
That is why I said Wendy Richards, meaning Richard apostrophe S, denoting the part that she played. You see, her
well,
name...
well tried, Clemens.
Well, her name is Wendy Richard, and she said I got her name wrong.
Wendy, you have a point, and you have 11 seconds on a good part to play, starting now.
I like the part that I play in EastEnders. Pauline is the salt of the earth, and she gets all the sympathy of the public. When Arthur, her husband, was having his breakdown, the fan mail came rolling in.
Just to remind our listeners, we might be getting a few new ones after 24 years, whoever is speaking when the whistle is blown gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Wendy Richard, who now is in the lead with Derek Nimmo at the end of the round. And Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, a hoax. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I suppose the first recorded hoax in history was that that took place outside the gates of Troy, when Ulysses and Menelaus got together and had this huge horse built, filled with soldiers, and persuaded the Trojans within that this was an offering to the gods, and they took it in through the wall at night, and after everyone had gone to sleep...
Wendy Richard challenge.
There's a couple of hesitations there, is there not?
There were, yes. I think we enjoyed the story, but you were very kind to let the first one go.
An old story.
Yes. But the old stories are the safest on just a minute. 39 seconds for you, Wendy, on a hoax, starting now.
Orson Welles got into serious trouble once when he was making this movie and he had this radio program...
Clement Freud challenge.
It wasn't a movie, it was
no,
a radio
program. It was
program.
A radio show, yeah. The War of the Worlds, H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds. It didn't make a movie.
Well, I saw about it in a movie.
I'm sorry, I disagree, Wendy. Clement had a correct challenge and he has 31 seconds on a hoax, starting now.
Quite a good hoax is trying to get into the Paris studio pretending that you're Derek Nimmo. Because you...
And Derek Nimmo challenged.
Well, he waited for the cheap laugh, so it was a hesitation.
Uh, And he got a round of applause. Derek, I agree, 23 seconds, a hoax starting now.
Horace de Vere Cole is known as one of the greatest hoaxers of this century. In particular, when a Cambridge graduate, he decided to visit the fleet dressed as the Sultan of Zanzibar, with Virginia Woolf with him, no less, mustachioed. They dreadnoughted the boat there, and all the sailors were gathered in front of him.
Richard,
he's talking rubbish.
Yeah. Drave is a deviation of English, isn't it? 5 seconds for you, Wendy, on a hoax starting now.
The person I was talking about earlier on did this radio programme about the war.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
You said radio twice.
You were talking about the radio. You did mention the radio before. You said the film and then the radio. So, Derek, I have to be fair, half a second, you devil, you've got him with half a second.
He walked down Piccadilly with a cow's udder sticking out of his flies.
So, Derek Nimmo was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and has gone into the lead at the end of that round. Wendy, Richard, your turn to begin. The subject is spending £1 million. A lovely thought. Will you tell us something about it, or what you might do starting now?
I wouldn't know how to go about spending £1 million, because I think that amount of money is far beyond my comprehension, as I only have the brain the size of a pea. So what I would do is, I suppose, as long as I was happy enough to have money to pay my bills, I don't need any more jewellery, I have sufficient, you can only wear so many bits and pieces. The same as I don't understand why people have more than one car, you can only drive one at a time. My husband is besotted with motor vehicles. I said, why? Why get yourself in a state?
Derek Nimmo challenge. Derek, what is your challenge?
Why?
Why, yeah. And I think you could have had her for deviation, because she's off spending the million. She's talking about not spending a million.
It was reported speech. It was her husband who'd actually repeated it, wasn't it?
Peter, lovely to hear from you at last. Well. Wonder where you've gone to. Yes. So anyway, the audience are on Wendy's side, but Derek Nimmo had a correct challenge. He has 25 seconds to tell us something about spending £1 million starting now.
I wish I had the money of Lord Nuffield or Rockefeller, so that one could give away millions of pounds to the many deserving, particularly environmental charities in this world with which I am concerned. Care Great Britain is one which I greatly approve of. In their interest this year, I've been to Bolivia,
Clement,
Peru...
Freud challenged.
Hesitation.
There was a hesitation. Here he paused for emotional effect, and I'm afraid... And Clement has got him with 8 seconds to go on spending £1 million, starting now.
I was going to say how very easy it is to spend £1 million, but was shamed by Wendy's extraordinary reticence and having only one small piece of jewellery.
Clement Freud gained the extra point. He's in second place behind Derek Nimmo, then Wendy Richard, then Peter Jones, in that order. Clement, your turn to begin. The subject we thought of is women's rugger. Will you try and tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
There are certain positional difficulties about women playing rugby football. For instance, when the judge says, "You ladies were found doing a loose ruck on Piccadilly Circus, what is your answer?" And the defendant says, "Milad, I am a hooker." It is jolly difficult to sustain that. Other sorts of places in which you might perform on the pitch would be full back, which doesn't sound nearly as good if you have skirts than if you have trousers. I've never seen women play rugby football, but it does seem...
Wendy Richard challenge.
We've had two rugby footballs, yes, instead of you women's rugger.
Yeah, women's rugger is the subject on the card, and you did mention football before, Clement. Uh-huh. And, oh dear.
I tell you what, Nicholas, in fairness to Peter, I'd like to hear Peter talk about women's rugger.
Don't be so cowardly, you know nothing about it.
Well, may he get in on it. Do you want to take the subject, Peter?
Not if it's charity.
Give Peter Jones a bonus point because we enjoyed his remarks and so did the audience. And Wendy, you were going to hear from you on women's rugger. 24 seconds, starting now.
I know nothing at all about women's rugger. In fact, I know very little about sport, not having much interest in it at all.
Peter, you challenged. What was your challenge?
Repetition.
Yes, repetition. Of people know. People know very little about, and you know very little about. You repeated the phrase, even.
Oh, so I did. Oh, dear.
So, Peter, you have 15 seconds to tell us something about women's rugger, starting now.
I didn't like playing rugger myself, and I wouldn't like to wish it on any woman that I know. Or don't. But boys at behind in the scrum used to drop little balls of mud down my shorts on the inside and then hit them from the outside.
Well, I'm glad we did hear from you on women's rugger, Peter. It's more like the boys' rugger, but you kept going to the whistle when gained that extra point. You're still in fourth place, but you're only one behind Wendy Richard, and one ahead of that is Clement Freud, and then two ahead is Derek Nimmo. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, getting your toe caught in the bath tap. That's what Ian Messer has come up for you here. Would you tell us something about that subject starting now?
Well, I suppose it's got the makings of a comedy routine in a film or television show, but of course you'd have to be in the nude.
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of course.
You did say of course.
At the beginning I said of course?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And then again just then.
Just then.
Oh, I see, yes. Yes.
Of course you did, Peter.
Yes, well, that's the end of that then.
Yes. 49 seconds for you, Clement, on getting your toe caught in the bath tap, starting now.
I've never quite understood why it is the fire engines are summoned to deal with people who catch their toe in the bath tap. But nevertheless, will you dial 999?
And Derek was the first to spot it, and the audience clapped because
triple
they spotted
nine.
It later. Yes, there were too many repetitions of nine. 21 seconds for you, Derek, on this subject, starting now.
It is extraordinarily painful if you get your toe caught in a bath tap, particularly if it is a hot one and it is still running. And when you try to lean forward to get hold of it, and you have a large corpulent belly, like some people, you can't actually manage to get hold of the tap to release it.
Yes, it's interesting to observe that sometimes a longer subject can be easier because they can repeat it all or parts of it if they wish. Derek, you were speaking as a whistle wind, gained the extra point. You're one ahead of Clement Freud at the end of round. It's your turn to begin. The subject is pigeons. Will you tell us something about those birds in this game, starting now?
Well, the first time the pigeons were used for conveying messages was during the Olympic Games, but the actual pigeon racing didn't start until the last century in Belgium, and I think the first piece of flight organised by these racing devils was at Antwerp.
Wendy Richard travelled.
Two racing?
No, race and racing.
Racing pigeons and racing.
Racing pigeons.
Oh, racing. All right, yes. Okay.
And Wendy got in first with 42 seconds on pigeons starting now.
In the north of England, racing pigeons are very highly thought of. And the chaps...
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why? Right.
Thought of very highly in the south of England as well.
I'm sure they're thought of highly, but it doesn't detract from the fact... Wendy,
yet.
Wendy, I am supporting you.
Thank you.
It doesn't detract from the fact... Don't be so sensitive. I try to be fair. And it also means they're thought of. She wasn't deviating from the subject of pigeons, because they are thought of highly in the north. Wendy, you have 37 seconds to continue with pigeons, starting now.
People like pigeons everywhere. And there's...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Deviation. I hate the things. I have them the side of my house and they excrete all over. They're all terrible, messy, foul, filthy bees.
So within trying to give you a message. I'm the only person here probably who's ever kept pigeons.
Well, you might get in on the subject, because actually, Derek, your challenge was not within the rules of just a minute, so Wendy keeps it, pigeons, and 32 seconds left, starting now.
One day last summer, when we had little Henry in his cage out on our patio, this pigeon flew down and went for his seed. It frightened the living daylights out of him, because he hadn't seen a pigeon before. But apart from those sort of pigeons that fly about and do make a mess, I do agree... They are very highly thought.
Clement Freud, chance.
Hesitation.
Yes, I agree, Clement. 14 seconds are left with you on pigeons starting now.
I bought a car sticker in New York which said, keep the streets clean, eat a pigeon. And I was very pleased indeed. I thought that showed exactly the right attitude because they are pretty disgusting animals. You can cook them.
Wendy, Richard,
chance. They're not animals, they're fowl.
They're animals.
Half a second with you, Clement, on pigeons starting now.
25 minutes in a Mark IV oven.
Some people find them particularly foul, but, I mean, that's beside the point. Clement Freud, speaking as the whistle went, has increased his lead at the end of that round. Peter, you said the only one who kept pigeons. What can you tell us about them as you didn't speak in that round?
Well, how long have I got?
As long as you want, if you make it good.
Well, I kept pigeons for a while. When I was a boy, I kept pigeons. I used to take them out in baskets and release them on my bicycle, and they couldn't ride, of course. But they didn't ever fly back. I always lost them. I had to keep getting more pigeons all the time. And this was in the Midlands. It wasn't the North or the South.
Yeah.
But people, I must say, were very fond of them.
And never came back.
Never came back.
Isn't that
didn't
sad?
Go home either.
Didn't go home. Did you go home?
Was that because you moved the bicycle, do you think?
I think we should give Peter a bonus point for all the pigeons he lost as a little boy. And we continue with Wendy, because it's your turn to begin, and it is finding luggage at the airport. That is the subject. Will you talk on it starting now?
Last September, my husband and I went on a very long trip. When we returned to the wrong airport, thanks to that wonderful airline that flies the flag, when we finally found our luggage...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
When we.
42 seconds to you, Derek, on finding luggage at the airport.
It is awfully difficult finding luggage at the airport, because when you get one of those trolleys, you always get one with only one wheel.
Clement Freud.
Always
you
repeat.
Always get one, yes. Clement, you've got him with 37 seconds on finding luggage at the airport, starting now.
Losing luggage at the airport is a much more usual practice.
And Peter Jones, a challenge.
Deviation.
Yes, of course. He was finding the subject is finding luggage, not losing luggage. Peter, you've got finding luggage at the airport and 34 seconds, starting now.
Finding luggage at the airport is the easiest thing in the world. You just go to the baggage hall and there's masses of it. Now, finding your own, of course, is a very different story. May not be at the same place.
Clement Freud, challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, you hesitated after you found your luggage, Peter.
Yes, I did. I was so pleased Clement with got that, it. Just, you know, little spark of life that I managed to get out.
I think you're still thinking about the pigeons you'd lost, actually.
Yes, I probably was, yes.
17 seconds, Clement, with you on the subject, starting now.
When the customs officer said, I'm afraid I cannot find your luggage, I said, but I had one piece in Gibraltar and the other in Malta, and there's surely no reason why they cannot both be here. To which the officer replied, I have heard that joke often before and got it better than you have. So I'm...
Clement Freud was then speaking as the whistle went. He's moved forward. He's in a stronger lead now ahead of Derek Nimmo. Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is What I Ate Last Night. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Last night I ate sausages and bubble and squeak.
And Derek Nimmo got in. Implied that he had repetition, but it was a pause. That
well, no wonder if he just had that, and no wonder he brought it back.
That's all I ate last night.
It's all he ate last night.
It would be dishonest to claim.
The audience enjoyed your ploy, Clement, and Derek was the first one to pick up the hesitation, so 56 seconds for you on the subject, starting
what
now.
What I ate last night at Great Milton started with some wonderful crudités and a very delicate sauce, and an assortment of canapés, great distinction. This was followed by a surprise, a tureen of vegetables with a cream liquid with them of great...
Wendy Richard Chan.
Got a bit of hesitation there, haven't we?
I don't think so.
I think so. The audience thinks so anyway, so that's enough for me. 29 seconds for you, Wendy, to tell us something about what I ate last night, starting now.
we discovered a really good new Indian restaurant. It's not actually a novelty to other people, but it was the first time we'd been there. And I ate prawn curry, mutter paneer, and then I had boiled rice, I had stuffed paratha, several poppadom, and then I had lime pickle, and I had mango chutney, and a...
Clement Freud challenged.
Too many hands.
Yes, you kept adding it.
Too many pickles.
Too many pickles. Clement, I agree with your challenge. You have 8 seconds on what I ate last night, starting now.
I'm afraid that I ate sausages and...
Very cute challenge, but what I'm going to do first, I know it, yes, we give Clement a bonus point because we enjoyed what he said, and I think it's only fair that...
I didn't enjoy what I said, I thought it was
He was being very sporting within the game.
It's the first time in his life he's ever told the truth.
But you still... You still get a point for correct challenge, Derek, and you take over the subject with 3 seconds to go, starting now.
A sort of fish cooked in seaweed, which was delicious.
At the end of that round, Clement Freud is still in the lead. He's 2 points ahead of Derek Nimmo, and then comes Wendy Richard, then Peter Jones in that order. Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, the telephone bill. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Telephone bills. Now, they come every quarter, and they're broken down quite often, I understand. I don't read all the material that comes with the bills. There's sometimes in the envelopes a lot of literature which I throw away, and so I don't entirely understand how they work out the cost of making a call. I know they're going to be more next year, though they do claim that they're going to be less because of the inquiries. They're going to charge 42p, is it something like that? And they say that the overall charge to each customer of British Telecom will be a certain percentage lower than it was in the quarters before. Now, have they all put down their things?
No, they haven't.
No, they haven't.
No. Derek Nimmo pressed his thing before on the 59th second. What is your challenge, Derek?
Well, deviation said, have you all put down your thing? Which has little to do with telephone bills.
Well, that could have been the receiver of the telephone, couldn't it? So, Peter, I disagree with the challenge. And you have 1 second on telephone bills, starting now.
Mercury is the answer.
Well, Peter Jones was then speaking as the whistle went. He's now equal in third place with Wendy Richard. They're just behind Derek Nimmo, and then Clement Freud is still just in the lead. And Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is What I Bet On. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I think the thing that I would bet on is the constancy of man's inhumanity to man. It always...
And Wendy Richard challenged.
To man's...
To man's
inhumanity to man. It's a well-known phrase, Nicholas.
So Wendy has a correct challenge, and she has 51 seconds to tell us something about what I bet on, starting now.
What I bet on is nothing, really. I don't approve of betting. When you go past these shops where one goes to put a bet on and you see it full of people standing there probably putting their last pounds and shillings...
Clement Freud challenged.
A repetition of pudding.
Pudding. There was too much pudding, I'm sorry.
Sorry. Yes.
So Clement's going to tell us something about what I bet on, and there are 38 seconds left, starting now.
I bet on just about everything. When I pass a betting shop, I always regret the fact that so many people inside smoke, and it is my ambition to have a no-smoking chain of such establishments, but for the fact that nobody would go in. Because the sad thing is, people who, what I bet on, are the sort of folk who have cigarettes and cigars and pipes and fumes and tobacco emanate from their mouths, noses and nostrils. Their ears are also contaminated
by nicotine. Deviation.
I was just...
Yes. Are you confident of that, Peter? Because that was your challenge.
Yes, I know. Oh, I'm 100%... Well... Good.
10 seconds. For you to tell us something about what I bet on, starting now.
I don't actually bet, though I would if I could find enough people to provide me with Havana cigars to go into some of these rather grand betting shops.
So, at the end of that round, Peter Jones is speaking as the Whistle Wind, gained that all-important extra point. He's now in third place, just ahead of Wendy Richard. And, Wendy, it's your turn to begin. The subject, window shopping. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I used to love window shopping at one time, but now London seems to be so overcrowded and people wandering all over the pavements, you can't actually get yourself a direct line up beside the window to shop in, can you? Because there's folk all over the place.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Well, hesitation.
I could call that hesitation. Yes, Derek. 44 seconds for you to tell us something about window shopping starting now.
Well, I wandered along Regent Street tonight, enjoying my window shopping most enormously. The windows were filled with the most glorious goodies imaginable, coming from the four points of the compass. I have never seen such an abundance of magnificence, delectable objects of every kind fairly priced, because all those window shoppers want to see a good buy. And the lights were strewn above, the pavements were clean, there was no litter.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Repetition of pavements.
Yes, you came down the pavement. Oh, it was pavement before, and this was pavements.
Oh, was it?
Mm.
Oh,
yeah. There are 12 seconds still with you, Derek, on window shopping starting now.
My wife stopped in a shop doorway and I continued walking along and I suddenly said...
Wendy Richard,
chunk. Walking
Chung.
Before?
You were walking before, Derek, yes, you did walk before.
I didn't
before.
Have a car.
I think you have a magnificent car, Derek, but you were walking on this occasion more than once. 7 seconds on window shopping with you, Wendy, starting now.
Regent Street.
And Derek Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation.
No.
I am not a ventriloquist. I can't speak without opening my mouth. Give me a chance to open my mouth.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition.
I haven't started.
5 seconds are left for you to keep going on window shopping starting now.
I don't know what part of Regent Street he was walking down tonight, but the streets weren't clean at all.
I wish Derek had had time to finish, because the last thing we heard about his wife was that he'd left her in a shop doorway. Very dangerous thing to do in this
and
area.
In Regent Street as well,
yeah,
yes.
I know.
But the prices were fair.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen of our audience, have you enjoyed yourselves?
Yes!
Wonderful. I will give you the final score. Peter Jones, coming from former triumphs, came in fourth place. But, no, he has triumphed magnificently in the past. Derek Nimmo, who's triumphed overwhelmingly in the past on occasions, didn't quite succeed in beating Clement Freud and Wendy Richard, who have 1 point more than him. So this week we adjudge them to be our joint winners. It only remains for me to say... On behalf of Clement Freud, Peter Jones, Derek Nimmo, Wendy Richard, thank you for being such a delightful audience. My thanks to Anne Ling, who keeps the score so magnificently, and of course our producer, Edward Taylor, without whom none of us would be here. We hope you've enjoyed it, and we'll want to tune in again the same time next week. And this is Nicholas Parsons, until then, saying goodbye. Wendy Richard and Tim Rice, and only for the second time on the show, Richard Stilgoe. Would you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits our producer's attractive secretary, Anne Ling, who has a whistle and a stopwatch to keep the score, and also blows the whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I will ask our four... competitors to speak, if they can, on the subject I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And we begin the show this week with Richard Stilgoe. Richard, the subject, oh, a delightful one, biscuits in bed. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
The last time I was on this programme, which was weeks and weeks ago, I didn't do particularly well, so I thought this time... I've been examining the...
Tim Rice, you're challenged.
Deviation, hesitation and repetition.
Which challenge are you going for?
I'll go for the lack of biscuit content in the... i.e. deviation.
It's coming to that.
No, I won't give deviation. Well,
but there again...
I would have given repetition of repeating this time.
I'll challenge for repetition.
It's a bit late now, Peter. You should have challenged before.
I'm not doing very well this time.
No, you are doing very well, Richard, because Tim challenged first. I disagree with his challenge of deviation, so you get a point for an incorrect challenge. You keep the subject. You have 52 seconds left. Biscuits in bed, starting now.
The way to make biscuits in bed. I thought you said that if I possibly wasn't myself, that if I'd be more successful on this program. The way to make biscuits in bed is...
Tim Rice challenge.
Repetition of successful.
Yes, you said at the beginning, yes.
Last time?
I wasn't very
but
successful
in a complete,
last time,
in a completely
yes.
different voice.
I know. A clever idea, Richard, but no, within the rules of the game, I think I have to say, yes, that was repetition of the word successful. Tim, you have a correct challenge. 43 seconds are left. Biscuits in bed, starting now.
Anybody eating biscuits in bed must be crackers. It is a very dangerous thing to do. Crumbs get everywhere and spoil almost every conceivable nocturnal activity. Who would be crazy enough to consume a...
Richard Stilgoe challenge.
I think there was a hesitation there.
There was definitely a hesitation. He was trying to think what he was going to consume while he was in bed. You take back the subject. Biscuits in bed, starting now.
Butter, sugar, and possibly some flour, all mixed together in a bowl, and then stirred around until it's time to put them into a baking dish, which you have greased carefully beforehand, before putting it into an...
Wendy Richard is challenged.
Much as I was enjoying that, it's actually biscuits in bed, and not in a greased baking dish.
No, I do think that was much more of a cooking recipe than biscuits in bed.
Yeah, yeah.
So I agree with your challenge of deviation, Wendy, and you take over the subject, having gained a point for a correct challenge, and 13 seconds are left, starting now.
Personally, I think eating biscuits in bed is quite a dreadful habit. It doesn't matter if one is consuming Garibaldi's Gypsy Creams or butter.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed. So we've heard from everybody on this first subject, which is nice. And there are 2 seconds left, Peter, very cleverly, got in just before. Biscuits in bed, starting now.
They go with Ovaltine, and it's not my idea of what beds were made for.
Just remind some who may be less familiar with the rules, whoever is speaking, when the whistle goes, gets the extra point. And it is on this occasion Peter Jones, who's equal in the lead with Richard Stilgoe at the end of the first round. Wendy, would you take the second subject? It is sunbathing. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I actually do not approve of sunbathing. It can cause premature aging of the skin, wrinkling, and cancer of the epidermis. When we were just on our holiday recently in rather hot parts of the world, I declined from sunbathing. I didn't come back as suntanned as some of our companions, but I felt it better to be safe than sorry. I did, in actual fact, have quite a healthy looking glow. In fact, some people said it was the best they'd seen me look for a long time.
Peter Jones Chung,
repetition of some people.
Another point, and the subject of sunbathing with 29 seconds starting now.
I'm trying to remember the name of that Greek person who was chained to a rock and pecked to death by eagles. I suggest that he might well have invented sunbathing. I'm not too keen on it myself. I don't like people to look terribly leathery like armchairs, you know, when they come back from their holidays. Not even Wendy, but of course she always looks delightfully and has a glow, whatever the time of day or year it is. Though I do think she's terribly disapproving. She's already told us that she doesn't approve of...
Though Peter got off the subject of sunbathing onto the subject of Wendy Richard, nobody challenged for deviation. He kept going till the whistle went. And Peter, it's your turn to begin. The subject is Birmingham.
I don't know how much you know about the city, but will you tell us something about it in this game starting now?
Brum, as it's called by some of the locals. Gilbert Keith Chesterton went there via Beachy Head, or he did in the poem. Probably quite a good route to Birmingham, because they're always spilling lorries, aren't they? Or their loads are falling off on the M1, and it might,
Tim Rice, chump.
Deviation.
Why?
I don't think there would have been lorries in Chesterton's time. Was it Chesterton he was going on about?
No. He did establish the M1 before that. And the M1 was certainly not in existence in Chesterton's time.
Exactly.
And
that's
therefore, lorries are on the M1, so I don't think he was deviating. He went from Chesterton, he had to keep going, he went on to the M1, which now goes to Birmingham, and he talked about lorries. I think his thought processes were perfectly straightforward, so I disagree with your challenge.
But it's just taken you 2 minutes to explain them.
I know. It just shows you how fair I like to be within the rules of just a minute.
And the M1 doesn't go to Birmingham, but we'll leave that.
Yes, I took the roundabout route to Birmingham, right. So, Peter, you have a point for an incorrect challenge. You keep Birmingham, and 43 seconds left, starting now.
On a personal note, I did my very first broadcast from Birmingham ages ago, and I had 4 lines in a play, and we rehearsed for the same number of days, so there was one day for each of the things that I said.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed, Tim. Right. 29 seconds for you on Birmingham, starting now.
The magical city of Birmingham has 3 major football teams, viz. Aston Villa, who play at Villa Park. West...
Stilgoe.
Repetition of Villa.
Yes, if you start to show off your knowledge of football, then... don't you? Richard, you got in with a correct challenge on 21 seconds on Birmingham, starting now.
People are always very rude about the city of Birmingham. For some years...
Tim Rice, challenge.
Deviation. I began by saying it was a magnificent city.
That's true.
Well, some people do say, but not you, Tim.
No, he said people are always rude about Birmingham, and I was not. Therefore, that was a deviation. He was inaccurate.
I was going to crawl to the city council as well later on.
He didn't say all people are always rude. He just said people are always rude.
I think he's right, Nicholas.
I've never known such generosity. 15 seconds left, Tim. Birmingham starting now.
The most stupid audience I've ever come across was from Birmingham. And they disagreed with every conceivable intelligent point of view about football teams from that country.
He's against that.
He mentioned football before.
You mentioned football before.
I think he's right.
Yes. Still trying to show off your knowledge of football. But there are 5 seconds on Birmingham with you, Peter Jones, starting now.
2 decades later, I was asked to go there again for another performance. But it didn't happen.
Peter Jones was once more speaking as the whistle went and has increased his lead at the end of that round. And Tim Rice, your turn to begin. The subject is commercial free gifts. Can you tell us something about those that happened to all of us through the post and elsewhere, starting now?
I would like to deal with this topic in 5 principal categories. Firstly, the reaction of the consumer on being told he has been given a commercial free gift.
Wendy, Richard...
Well, actually, I think I've made a ricket, because I thought there was 2 commercials.
No, commercial is on the...
I beg your pardon, Mr. Rice.
And so you pick it up again, Tim, with 50 seconds to go. Commercial free gifts starting now.
Thirdly, what about the damage this can do to the economy? People have never thought, when issuing these reckless free presents around the shop, just how much harm they can do to goods that have to be paid for and earned by toil, honest sweat, blood. I wish somebody would interrupt me.
Peter Jones has.
Well, I interrupted because he wanted someone to. It was kind of...
What do you want to give the challenge?
What?
What is your challenge, then?
Deviation.
Another point to you, Peter. 31 seconds left. Starting on commercial free gifts. Starting now.
I don't really like receiving these offers because they always prove to be the...
So Wendy got
that
in with the...
temptation.
Yes, 25 seconds, Wendy. Commercial free gifts. Starting now.
Commercial free gifts really irritate me. How many of us sitting here have received those letters through the post saying you've won a car, a villa in Spain, a pearl necklace, a gold lighter or watch or whatever? And really, all they want to do is to get you along to some office, not too far from here, I might add, and try and force you into buying some timeshare place. And when you get there, you find you haven't won anything at all.
Wendy, you kept going very fluently to the whistle, Wendy. Have you actually had personal experience of that?
Well, we've had about three letters now, haven't we, saying we've won a car. I would actually love to turn up and see what they said. You know, if you really have got your car, or if you've got to buy one of their timeshare places.
Nicholas, there was a great fuss quite recently, because Edward Heath got sent one of these things and went along to this timeshare meeting, and everybody was sitting there saying, why is Edward Heath there? And Edward Heath was sitting there saying, where's my Ford Fiesta?
And what did they reply in
Baghdad? I think he did it quite deliberately in order to show up the system, and I think it worked very well.
And Richard, it's your turn to begin. The subject is rotten guests. Will you tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now?
It's something I didn't know very much about until about 15 minutes ago when...
Tim Rice challenged.
Two abouts.
Two abouts.
Oh, yes.
Tim, you have a point. The subject, 56 seconds, rotten guests, starting now.
I once had some rotten guests to my humble abode, Johnny Rotten and his family. I was extremely worried about this because I'd heard of the reputation of the said clan. I thought they might spit on the carpet, use foul language, torment the dog, and destroy the wallpaper, which had only recently been placed on several of the walls.
Richard challenged.
Well, I think it was the hesitation.
Oh, yes. Give over.
Yeah. No, there was a hesitation. You couldn't remember where you placed your wallpaper.
I was just thinking, was wall a repetition of wallpaper? And I decided not, so I went ahead with confidence.
But it was hesitation. So, Wendy, you have another point. You have the subject of rotten guests. 36 seconds, starting now.
I have had my fair share of rotten guests. When my mother was alive, we had a bed and breakfast hotel. I know all about rotten guests. I know about the ones who sneak out in the morning without paying their bill.
Peter Jones challenged.
Know about, she said twice.
You repeated, I know all about.
It's a brilliant story.
Well, try and get in again, Wendy, and tell us more about it. 23 seconds are left. And it's Peter Jones on rotten guests, starting now.
Well, the guests that I think are rotten are the ones to whom you say, please make yourself at home, and they do. And you can't get rid of them. Week after month, they stay there until they really take up residence, like squatters. And they're, in particular...
Richard Jones.
I thought there was a little hesitation.
It was hesitation, Richard, and you have another point and 5 seconds to tell us about rotten guests, starting now.
One of the worst things that rotten guests can do is not turn up at all, at least not at the time that you say that they are to arrive at your house.
And Richard Stilgoe was speaking as a whistle when gained that all-important extra point. And he's now in second place behind Peter Jones, our leader. And Wendy, it's your turn to begin. The subject is What I Like, and you have 60 seconds to begin, starting now.
What I like best of all is listening to the Archers on a Sunday morning between 10:15 and 11. This is my most...
Tim Rice challenge.
Deviation from the truth. The Archers is 10:15 to 11:15, not 10:15 to 11.
But she only enjoys it from 10:15 to 11.
I was 10:15, had I?
Yes.
How could I forget the last quarter hour? It's always the most exciting.
Exactly.
In that case, repetition of 15.
You can't win, can you?
So, what do we do? What's your challenge, Tim? It was a deviation, then, was it?
Deviation, yes.
Right, yes. Tim, you have the subject of What I Like, and 53 seconds left, starting now.
I like listening to the Archers, but what I like even more is turning in and tuning on to Neighbours, that fantastic Australian soap opera, an Antipodean delight. I am constantly amazed by the beautiful elocution, the wonderful...
Tim, Wendy, Richard...
Deviation, the man's talking rubbish.
I I think the audience applause endorses the correctness of your challenge, Wendy. So you get a point for that.
No,
and 30.
No, you see, these people go and they think you really do watch it.
I do. I love it. I'm telling the truth.
I'm sitting over there next time.
Well, I think that the artist does deserve all the plugs we're giving it, so I think they do have quality. 38 seconds are left with you, Wendy, on What I Like, starting now.
Apart from listening to the Archers, the other thing I like is our little pet cockatiel, Henry. She is... Well,
Tim Rice challenge.
She paused with emotion after mentioning Henry.
It's only because I forgot whether it was a he or a she. There's some confusion over the little thing.
After all this time, don't you know, Wendy?
Well, we think it's a female.
Why did you call it Henry?
We thought it was a little boy, but now we think it's a little girl.
Oh.
It's
why?
It's a very kind of bleak life that you seem to lead. When the high spots are listening to the Archers and cleaning out the parrot's cave.
If any of our listeners have any ideas on how Wendy could improve the quality of her life, would you please put it on a postcard? But you do keep the subject of What I Like, and you have 31 seconds left, starting now.
The other things I like, apart from the aforesaid items and subjects, are walking in the park, especially in the autumn. I do like to see the leaves lying on the ground. I know they make a bit of a mess and some poor soul has to come along and sweep them up. But when you look at the varying shades of gold and red and brown and you see the bits falling off the trees and fluttering downwards, it really is a most wonderful sight, especially if you live near...
Richard Stilgoe, yes.
Hesitation.
Oh, yes, I have to hear
I
just to be sure.
I couldn't think of another word for park. I want to say Regent's Park. I couldn't. I'd already
that
said
that would have been
park,
all right.
I know, and if you kept going for one more second, you'd have got another point.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Richard got in with 1 second to go on What I Like, starting now.
Sex in cockatiels is what I like most.
Richard Stilgoe was speaking as a whistle wind, gained an extra point. He's now 1 point behind our leader, who's still Peter Jones. Peter, your turn to begin. The subject is ready money. 60 seconds as always, starting now.
Ready money is what Lane didn't have at the beginning of The Importance of Being Earnest when he was asked about cucumbers because they were preparing the sandwiches for Lady Bracknell. Ready money is a very handy thing to have, as Ken Dodd has found out over the years. But sometimes it can be an embarrassment if you have too much of it locked up in the garden shed. Now, I've never been terribly well off ready money-wise, but would like to acquire some, and if anybody can make any suggestions after the show about ways in which I could earn a few quid, I should be very pleased to indulge them in quite a long conversation. I'm not used to having very extended ones, but I would be prepared to go on until, say, 9:30, if necessary, talking about ready money. If anybody's got a suitcase full of it, I should be even more delighted. But alas, you look a poverty-stricken crowd and are fairly unhappy, I should think, with it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here.
Well, Pete, I'm delighted to see that ready money really inspired you. It's the first time for a long time anyone, let alone Peter, has kept going for the full 60 seconds without hesitation, repetition or deviating and without being interrupted for any other reason. You're 3 ahead of Richard Stilgoe in second place, and we carry on with Tim Rice to begin the next round, and the subject is dentists. Give us painful or even different experiences on dentists, starting now.
It is amazing how many dentists are Australian. If you hear that particular Antipodean accent, you can put almost every bit of ready money you have on the fact that this gent will be from the place I mentioned. Also coming from that area are cockatiels, but I digress, and this is not something I would...
Richard, still go challenge.
If he digresses, I would imagine that's deviation.
Yes, he is admitting himself that he deviated. So, Richard, well listened, well challenged. A point more to you, 44 seconds on dentists, starting now.
The reason that Australians come over here and join the dental profession is because of a thing called bashing the Nash. This is a way of earning enormous quantities of money by being somebody arriving from another country
dentistry who is already qualified and then joining the National Health, and you get paid more than ordinary dentists who are qualified over here. I've just said the word qualified twice, but it's jolly interesting.
Jim Wright,
that,
isn't it?
Yes, two qualified.
Yes, yes, there were two highly qualified there. Dentist is back with you, Tim, and 28 seconds are left, starting now.
I had an extremely trendy dentist back in the 70s who would plug in super earphones into his patient, which was often me when I was there, and play sensational music while he slowly stoned you out of your skull.
Peter Jones challenge.
You can't plug earphones into the patient.
Well, you can. I mean,
you're absolutely right, Peter. The mind boggles at the thought. Correct challenge, 16 seconds on dentists, starting now.
Another trendy thing, they've done away with the chairs, and now they have the patients lying down on their backs. And I think quite soon they'll be lying on their stomachs so that
challenge.
They can have easier access to their wallets.
Too long.
Oh, Peter, the joke was worth waiting for. But Tim did challenge you before you got to the payoff. What was it, Tim?
Two lying.
Two, there were two lyings, I'm afraid.
Lying,
so, Tim, you're back with 7 seconds on dentists, starting now.
With music in my ears, he would...
Richard Stilgoe challenge.
Repetition of ears.
That's right, they were plugged into your ears before and there was music in your ears this time. Richard, you're catching up on our leader, Peter Jones. You have 5 seconds on dentists, starting now.
I don't know whether it's the smell that's worse or the noise of the drill, but that particular scent...
Again, speaking of the whistle, Wayne Gain, that... extra point again, and he's now one behind our leader, who is still Peter Jones. And Richard, it is your turn to begin. The subject is old codgers. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
It was one of the Sunday papers. I can't remember which its name was, but they used to answer their letters.
Wendy, Richard,
it's wrong. It wasn't the Sunday paper, it was the Daily Mirror.
Oh, all right. Well, at least I know now.
The Daily Mirror talked about the old codgers, did it? Mm. Right, well done, Wendy. I'm glad you read your newspapers. 55 seconds on old codgers, starting now.
I used to read the old codgers column in the Daily Mirror. They used to have people write in with various obscure requests and asking for...
Tim Rice challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation on the requests, and there are 45 seconds left. Old codgers with you, Tim, starting now.
I'm at an extremely interesting phase of my life between being a juvenile dynamo and an old codger. It is extremely difficult to relate to this situation. It's called the midlife crisis, and I can tell you one and all, it's hell. You are not getting the sympathy you deserve from your fellow workers or indeed from the public. You are too old to be young and loved, and too young
and youthful. Wendy, your challenge.
I think we had two youngs,
yes,
didn't
sorry.
We?
Yes, indeed they did. 21 seconds. Old codgers, starting now.
The old codgers item in the newspaper I mentioned before was really interesting because they dealt with such varied queries, as I said, from people who would purchase.
Tim Rice, challenge.
Repetition.
Of what?
Well, you said, as I said, so you must have repeated something.
She didn't actually repeat anything. She said, as I said, but she was using different words that thought before.
Oh, well, sorry.
So you keep the subject, Wendy. Another point, 9 seconds. Old codgers, starting now.
There are some lovely elderly chaps come into our local we refer to as the old codgers. They're from the Royal Hospital in Chelsea, and they're an absolutely splendid band of gentlemen. Mm.
Well, Wendy, Richard not only got a point for speaking as a whistle went, but gained a number of points in that round and has leapt forward from fourth to third place. And as we go into the last round, it's a very interesting situation. Only one point separates each competitor, and we move into the last round with tension, and the subject is pets. And Wendy, it is your turn to begin. So cockatiel away if you wish. Starting now.
I used to have a pet dog, a little poodle, that I had for 12 and a half years, and then I also had a pussy cat, which I called Pussy, because I was very imaginative.
Tim Rice,
the other one's a name. It's the name. It had a capital
pussy
P.
Cat. I suppose pussy cat isn't hyphenated or anything, is it?
Yes, oh. But
some
pussy,
cats
the second
are.
Pussy,
yes.
Was a capital P.
If you'd said a hibernated pussycat, then we would have known, right. Tim, I give you the benefit of the doubt, and there are 50 seconds left on pets, starting now.
I have an enormous dog called Tyson, who is a boxer. This is an extremely witty play on words, but it suits him. He is a vicious beast, so I would like to inform anybody in the audience after some ready money from my house not to come near, because this animal will tear you from limb to arm. Or leg.
Wendy Richard Challenge.
Hesitation,
yes, from limb to arm. Wendy, that's justice. You've got the subject back. 29 seconds left on pets, starting now.
After my other pets died, I got a pet cockatiel called Henry, who is the love of my life. He or she...
Richard Stilgoe.
Oh, sorry, she corrected it.
Wendy gets another point for the interruption, and she has 20 seconds to continue on pets, starting now.
Can fly around our flat whenever they wish.
Tim Rice Challenge.
Well, there's only one bird, as far as I can gather. It's confusing, and I think the bird himself probably is in some doubt about that. She just said they fly around.
She did indeed, yes. Tim, you have a correct challenge. I give it to you. Pets, back with you, 19 seconds, starting now.
It is not widely known that there are several pets in this country which are illegal. You are not allowed to keep.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
It's very widely known indeed.
Judge on that. Is it widely known or not widely known?
Of course it is. The audience know it is. Of course it
is. I will
is.
Then put it to the superior wisdom and judgment of our delightful audience. Will you please, if you agree with Peter's challenge, cheer for Peter, and if you disagree, then you boo for Tim Rice, and you do it all together now. Hooray! I think the cheers have it, which means that they agree with Peter, that most people do know this. 14 seconds, pets, starting now.
The thing I don't like about having a pet is that one has to leave it at home occasionally or farm it out somewhere. There are little hotels I know that you can leave animals at.
But it's a Stilgoe challenge.
Two leaves. Oh, that's right, yes.
Yes, indeed.
Sorry,
yes.
It's a very short word.
I know, it's all very tense, it's very equal, and 3 seconds left with Richard Stilgoe on pets, starting now.
The Stilgoe's family dog is called Patrick, and he is a yellow Labrador. A lot of people refer...
Well, we've reached the end of the show. We have in second place a pairing of Tim Rice and Wendy Richard, but only 1 point behind our joint winners, Richard Stilgoe and Peter Jones. What could be fair in the result? It only remains me to say thank you to all four of them for the wonderful contribution they make towards the success of our programme. I also wish to thank Anne Ling, who has kept the score and blown her whistle so magnificently beside me, and of course Ian Messiter, who created the game, and our producer, who makes sure we all toe the line so magnificently. And from me, Nicholas Parsons, we hope you've enjoyed just a minute and will want to tune in again the next time we take to the air and play this game. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye.